Thanks for listening to the Von Haessler Doctrine Podcast. Remember, you can hear the show every weekday from 9 to noon right here on 95.5 WSB, Atlanta's news and talk. Live from Sherwood Forest in the heart of Atlanta, Georgia, hour one of the Von Haessler Doctrine begins right now. I am your lovable, huggable, mid-morning chat host, Eric Von Haessler, surrounded by the Doctrinaires, man of a thousand voices, Tim Andrews, lady of quite a few voices in her own right, Autumn Fisher, and the handsomest producer in all of producery, Jared Yamamoto.
Good morning, Eric.
Well, good morning. So when is the president going to speak? Do we know?
We don't have an exact time, but we're hedging bets right now.
My guess is in the 10 o'clock, yes?
When Fox and Friends is over.
Oh, first you have to watch. Okay, all right.
So I never miss it.
I understand. You want to get your daily diet.
That's right.
And maybe a constitutional. And then,
mean a walk?
Yeah, a walk. Maybe a little walk around the grounds. Maybe relieve yourself before you go out and speak to people.
Well, I got a Fitbit, and I don't like going outside. So I'm just going to walk around the White House lawn.
Hey, you know, you and I are a lot of...
I know.
When it comes to diet and exercise...
Hey, you want to hang out?
Yeah, why not? Sure, if I get to hang out with you.
Oh, yeah.
You don't want to come hang out with me.
Now, one of the promises we can make you, Eric, is that we're going to carry that press conference right here on 95.5 WSB Live.
My guess is it'll be in the 10 o'clock hour. I don't know that to be true, and my guess is it'll be a short statement without any questions. First, I guess we should just go. Should I just go ahead and open this up since I'm going to talk about Iran? All right, let's go ahead. Let's do it.
Headlines for Wednesday, January 8th.
So last night, I'm in my office of the Von Haessler compound, and I was watching some sports analysis show on my computer, and then I started to notice the push alerts on my phone and saw something was going down. So I don't usually, but I turned to CNN. Who's on CNN at 7 o'clock at night?
That would be Erin Burnett.
Oh, my goodness. Miss Grimface. I mean, just the look, just the grimness of it all. And somewhat, this has just happened. You know, the fact that Iran was shelling a couple of bases in Iraq where U.S. forces are from Iran, and the Iranian government was not trying to say it wasn't them. That's the new thing here. That, I mean, they've been shelling us and doing things from militias, and even sometimes even, I think, from Iran, but they act like it's not them. This was an official state response. And I tune into, what's her name? Erin Burnett?
Erin Burnett.
Miss Grimm.
Her show is called Erin Burnett Out Front.
Oh, all the shows have a name. Isn't that funny? You know, I have.
They all have a name. How dare they?
Yeah, well, they all have this like they all this like All In with Chris Hayes. That's MSNBC, right? I see them in my guide for the internet TV that I have, and they all have like all these hosts. They're like rock stars from the 70s. Like there's a shot of them looking like it's their album cover. It's All In with Chris Hayes. Erin, what's hers called? All Out with Erin Burnett?
Erin Burnett Out Front.
Oh, look at this. Right. She's out front. He's all in.
She's out front before the prime time at 8.
I see. Oh, she's out front.
Yeah,
I get it.
She's getting you set up for
he's
the 8
o'clock. He's all in because he's not on to what, 10?
Yeah.
I don't know. So I'm starting to.
I call.
I'm starting to understand. But so she's literally, this has just happened. And I'm making a serious point here. This is when I'm tuning in. The news is just breaking at the point that we knew the whole thing. You know, the attacks had come from Iranian soil. The Iranian government was claiming the attacks. They hit two bases in Iraq and where U.S. troops are. And then later on, we found out, which I was wondering from the because I have reason when I'm looking at these things. What exactly am I looking at? We found out no Americans were killed, and we still think no Iraqis were killed. At the time when I tuned in, when it was just... I mean, you would have thought, I mean, this Miss Grimm, what's her name? Erin
Burnett.
Miss Grimm. I mean, we were in all-out war as far as that footing was going. You know, so there was no doubt that this is very grim. The underlying message was that Trump, we told him, here we go. That was the whole thing. Here we go into some wider war, a large war. My wife starts getting upset. I'm like, hey, stop it. Just be... And then I start looking at what the problem is here. We have a lot of news in this country. We've got 24-hour news channels. We have blogs, the internet. We have radio. But almost none of it is really equipped to handle stories like this. Stories that are important, stories that are big, stories that involve national security, and stories that aren't done. They're unfolding in real time. The problem with so much of our coverage in on 24-hour networks and the blogs and everything is so much of the lifeblood of reportage these days is based on the hot take. Right now, and I guarantee you, the producers, when they call these people, they're going to get a round table. Well, your hot take. Well, if you're talking about what is really going on between Brad Pitt and Jennifer Aniston, maybe a hot take is at the very least innocuous. Who cares if it's right or wrong? There's no legitimate place for any hot take on the events that happened last night. No one said anything that you can count on within 15 minutes of finding out what happened in Iran and Iraq last night. It's simply not legitimate. It's not news. It's not reporting. But you are less likely to change the channel or go to a different website if the people that you've come to trust are telling you we might be on the precipice of a very large war. Eric von Haessler is here to say that would surprise me. If that turned out to be true, that would surprise me. But here's the thing about the von Haessler doctrine. We're really good at what we do. We don't need national emergencies to keep people from tuning away. The show's just damned entertaining. So we don't have to rely on that crutch. I have no need to scare the hell out of you this morning in order to keep you listening. You're just going to keep listening because if you go away for too long, you're going to miss that thing your friend tells you about tomorrow. By having a daily show that's entertaining based on current events, we can do this, and we have this ability. So I'll tell you what's really going on. In reality, so far of what we know, Iran just put on a show for its own people and nothing more. And we'll see if the president takes it up a notch. I don't think he will, and I don't think it would be smart for him to do that. This is what you need to know. Apparently, there was so much warning on this stuff that the sirens, the warning sirens and everything on the bases were going off 2 hours before the first missiles landed. Iran called Iraq and told them this was going to happen. My understanding is they didn't tell them the exact bases, but all you got to do is tell them and we knew. There's some who believe that through back channels, Iran let the U.S. know that this was going to happen. This is what you need to understand. Soleimani, or however you say his name, General of the Quds Force, was the second most powerful person in the state of Iran, in the country of Iran. Now, there may be people listening who will take this the wrong way. I don't care. You got to just keep up with me. From the point of view of Iran, they had to do something. In the eyes of their own people, they had to do something. And what I maintain is they put on a fireworks show for their own people. And the thing that was different about it is it wasn't a proxy. They just went on board. They said, we launched them from Iran, and that was our strike. If you look at their statement, which somebody can pull up from Javed Avi, the spokesperson that you're always hearing from. The statement talks about how the launches happened and have been concluded. The word concluded was in there. And that this was our response. Everybody needs to just relax. I'm sorry, CNN, and my apologies to MSNBC and Fox News as well. I don't think you're going to get the war that you're hoping for. I don't think, what I mean to say is, and you'll hear that right in your editorial newsrooms, what I just said was, I don't think you're going to get the ratings that you're hoping for. I'm hoping that when the president speaks, it's pretty obvious that he understands If we took out their number two guy, that's what needs to be understood. From their point of view, he was the second most powerful person in that government, above the president and just below the Ayatollah. If we took him out, and what we got in response is we have to reconstruct a few airstrips at bases, ultimately, we won. This round, we won. We took out their second most powerful person, and they took out a couple of buildings and airstrips. From what we know so far, no casualties. And it looks like they didn't want casualties. They needed their people to see that they did something. Now, the threats are still there, and they're still the same as they were 24 hours ago. Asymmetrical proxies. Continuing to ping us here, ping us there, cyber warfare. All of those things are still on the table that were on the table 24 hours ago. But Iran knows that they cannot win an all-out war with the United States. There is no doubt about that. And the way Trump would fight that war, I don't think he wants that war, but I think I understand his thinking on this stuff enough to know that he would not fight it in the 2000s way of Iraq and nation building, and we have to go in there and we have to do everything. If we were to fight Iran through this president, which I don't think is going to happen, but if we did, I think we'd only have as many boots on the ground that could make sure the stuff we were doing from the air worked. Most of that being covert, some of it being some people on the ground. But this would be B-52s and drones, and the reason that that can be done that way is because Trump's not going to give a damn who rebuilds the nation afterward. So he's not going to get in there and try to, like the neocons' idea is, well, let's flip them to a democracy. We went through that experiment. So from Trump's point of view, if he went to war with Iran, I believe it would have very little to do with boots on the ground. Now, on the other hand, there are people who want war with Iran. And I'm surprised this morning I heard Sebastian Gorka on TV, and his whole thing was basically Trump's response is going to be so massive that they'll know this was the biggest mistake. That I hope Trump's not taking his call.
The fire and the fury.
Yeah, yeah, he seemed very excited about it.
Well, you know, I was feeling a lot of pain yesterday, and then I took Relief Factor.
I don't need to know your commercials, Sebastian.
When I take Relief Factor, I'm able to sleep on my pillow. Which
what,
is
you
made
have your
out
own radio
beats.
Show now? Is that why you're
it's
doing
made
this?
Made out of beats, yes. Dr. Sebastian
Gorka. Is this the Black
Gorka.
Cherry Super Beats?
Black Cherry Super Beats. They're fantastic when you're trying to fight your evil empire.
We had a couple of mics that I heard earlier today.
Oh, not, yes.
The ones I told you about, I heard coming in, and I thought, no, this is exactly the wrong response.
You mess with the bull, you get the horns. Iran is going to pay.
I hope President Trump blows Iran away.
What the hell do you mean by that? A nuke? A nuke over Tehran? I mean, this emotional, this is what I'm hoping is not happening at the White House. Again, if we get to 2 weeks from now and we look back and the tit for tat was, we took out the second most powerful person in their government and the person most responsible for their military strategies that are usually against us and our allies. And in response, we had to rebuild a couple of airfields and buildings on a base. We won 100% hands down. And then you go back to default. Like I said, there are still, what is Iran going to do now? They've signaled that they're done with this phase. But they're going to go back to the thing that was exactly the problem yesterday. The world has not changed. Since the threats concerning Iran have not changed since 24 hours ago. The thing that's changed is they put on a fireworks show for their own people between then and now. And that's the reality. And we should react to it as the reality that it is. The next time you want to get on your open mic and start talking about the bull by the horns, you think about the blood and treasure that we've spilled over there over the last, you know, almost 20 years now. You really think we need to, you know, there's that old phrase of, was it bad money after good? You know, are we really, you want to double down now? Next time you're at we're out of high school football season, but you still get my point. Look around. You know, as you're getting all emotional about the bull by the horns and, You know, how many of those kids on the field are you willing to lose? For what? There's no chance Iran can beat us in a war. And they know it. And there's no need for war. CNN and MSNBC and Fox News don't want you to change the channel. It's in all of their interest to make you believe there's possibly a wider war is coming. Thankfully, part of your media diet is the Von Haessler Doctrine, a non-desperate, fantastic show. We could do great shows if there was never another scandal. We don't need that. You're with us because we're good. You know why we're here. And we're always going to be straight with you. I say there will not be a wider war because there shouldn't be a wider war. Now, we'll find out when the president speaks which way he's going. My guess is a little bit deflating of the rhetoric. I could be wrong. That's another thing. I'm the only host that will admit that to you as well.
Get your daily dose of comic relief with Eric Von Haessler mornings at 9. Then shake off the daily stress.
And it's gonna be all right.
With Mark Arum weeknights at 6 on 95.5 WSB.
So Trump's going to speak at 11. We're going to carry it.
That's right. We're going to carry it live right here on 95.5 WSB. And what are you going to pay up? You know, I was close to the time there.
We were taking we're doing a little game behind the scenes. Were you closest without going over?
Yeah.
I thought it would be in the 10 o'clock hour. So, yeah. All right. What do I owe you? Lunch or something now?
That sounds great. Actually, I would like
that. That sounds great.
I believe that the proper thing to do would be to de-escalate at this point. We took out their number two guy. And they caused some damage on some bases, and no lives were lost. They had to put on a show for their people. And so I hope that maybe he talks about doubling down on the economic sanctions or something like that. But I don't think there should be anything more kinetic between us and them in this round. And like I said before, again, I keep repeating myself, look, there are still threats, but they're the same threats as yesterday. This was a show Iran put on for their people. They warned Iraq. They warned us. That's the reason, though. There were places to kill Americans closer to the Iranian border. They did not do that. This was a show they put on for their people for purposes of interstate propaganda. And hopefully when Trump speaks, he will de-escalate. That's my prediction, is he'll do that, because I think that's what he should do. There's no reason to ratchet this up, because we can see by what Iran did, it was just a show. It wasn't meant. And they said, oh, we slapped you in the face and blah, blah, blah. But in terms of statecraft, they had to do something in the eyes of their own people. I don't mean and don't get me wrong, I don't mean their people love them and love the government. I'm just talking about their own self-preservation as being seen as a strong government to their own people. So now they can go back to their own people. They can say, hey, we bombed the Americans, and no one's going to ask any questions because no one wants it. Iran certainly doesn't want it. I don't think Trump's base wants it. I don't think Trump became president to start another war in the Middle East. And I think he knows that. So that's my prediction. I guess it's kind of a wish as well, because my reading of this is that Iran did the bare minimum, feeling they had to do something, and they owned it. And we need to kind of step away now and worry about the real threats, the same ones from 24 hours ago, asymmetrical. By the way, I'm still very focused on my rally for Rayford. Rayford Trey Young, some people can check my math on this. I believe that I can declare that he has now been held hostage by the Atlanta Hawks for 556 days. This is outrageous. You can check my math. He was signed July 1st, 2018. I believe that would make this 556 days of being held hostage by the Atlanta Hawks. Now, they should either let him go or bring more people in who can help him win games. That's all I'm going to say. Rally for Rayford. you got other stories? I know we kind of We'll get back to Iran. It's obviously going to come up again and again. I don't want people to think that we're going to walk away from it forever, but there are other stories.
Yeah, I got a big local one for you, Eric.
A local story, you say? Do you mean, when you say local, do you mean the state of Georgia, the United States of America, Atlanta, Roswell?
Hyper-local. I'm going to say Atlanta.
Atlanta.
This involves Atlanta Mayor Bottoms.
Uh-huh.
She said that she's going to be campaigning for Joe Biden in Iowa this Friday on the We Know Joe tour.
Well, that's it. Just hand him the nomination, right?
This really puts me over top, I was like, I like her down there. Where's she from?
She's from Atlanta.
Georgia?
Georgia, the state of Georgia.
God, we're going to do so good down in Georgia. Got a lot of good people down there.
Going to turn this blue this time around?
Going to turn Georgia blue. It's already purple. I don't even got campaign down there. I just know I'm going to win it.
You know, I was thinking about this yesterday. Honestly, think about the fact that Stacey Abrams has said that she's not going to run against Kelly Loeffler. Is that her name?
Correct.
Is that her name? Kelly Loeffler?
I'm Kelly Loeffler.
Yeah, okay. I'll leave a message.
I grew up on a farm.
But if you, I know you grew up on a farm. Really think about this. I know we've talked about it, but really focus on it for a moment. Just how full of it Stacey Abrams is. Why isn't she running for Senate when there's an election right now? If you take Stacey Abrams by her word and all the people who believe her and propagate her spin on things, the voters of Georgia were just recently denied the governor that they wanted. Governor is a statewide race. Senator is a statewide race. If you really believe that less than a year ago, the governorship, was it less than a year ago or more than a year ago?
More than a year ago now.
It's hard to believe. Time just flies.
Isn't it crazy? Yeah.
But
in the
last governor's race, just a year ago, you honestly believe that the people, the state of Georgia, they should be completely up in arms and waiting to go back and vote for Stacey Abrams again because they were denied. I mean, you wouldn't even, that should be a shoo-in. You're just giving the people of Georgia the chance that they were denied. They're not denied, but it was apparently stolen from them. If you really believed this, why would you opt out of running for statewide office with something that's this wide open that the Republicans can't even agree upon who should be taking that seat? That makes it fragile right there. You're not dealing with, somebody who's won a bunch of times just running again. This is a kind of a wide open thing. I mean, it really just shows. It's quite obvious. Even Stacey Abrams doesn't believe Stacey Abrams' spin. And maybe Joe Biden's waiting for her to be the vice president. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm going to ask her. It's Liz there. She's going to get Julian. Yeah. I got to have somebody good like Stacey.
Corn Pop was a bad dude.
Stacey knew how to handle Corn Pop's gut right beside her head with him.
You used to carry chains around, I guess, bicycle chains.
I had to carry chains around. You know what Stacey Abrams got chains around? She got good. She don't need chains. What she needs to carry around is her brain and her wit, and she can take care of Corn Pop real good. Also, a nice ham hock to the face.
Hey, Joe, I think Corn Pop left an open mic.
Hey, Corn Pop here. I'm looking for Joe Biden, that sorry sack of crap.
Corn Pop was a bad dude.
Hey, guys, I got to go. Hey, listen,
wait a minute. You got to stand your ground, Joe Biden.
No. Corn Pop's here. I've got my guys with me. I gotta go.
Can't be that easy. Yeah, I think endorsements. I don't know if they help really anybody. I think Judge Judy's endorsement of Bloomberg is probably, even though endorsements are never going to put you over the top, it's probably a little more effective. I'm told that a bunch of suburban housewives love Judge Judy. That's what I'm told.
What's your source?
My source is this is what they're looking for, right? That's the whole Kelly Loeffler thing,
I'm Kelly Loeffler.
The idea is these Republican women in the suburbs don't like Trump's personality. So you got it, right?
I agree with that sentiment. I don't know a lot about anything about politics.
Right.
But if Judge Judy endorses them, I think she's smart. She's a smart cookie. You can't get one over on her.
Yeah. The fact that they've known each other for 40 years has nothing to do with this. This is just purely an observation. Just objective.
She's an objective. She's a judge.
She would
never do something just because
she's a TV judge.
She knows.
She's still a judge.
She's a TV judge.
But she was a judge, I think.
Yeah. Okay. Where? Before. I know she was, but everybody leans
Ask
on
me.
That.
Ask me where.
Where was she the judge?
South Dakota.
Yeah, right. Yeah, they went and found a judge in South Dakota. Gave her own television show.
Nebraska.
I would imagine it was probably in the state of New York. Probably in New York City. I don't know that
New
for
York
a fact.
City.
God. But
if he wins, are we not going to be able to buy soda anywhere when he becomes president?
Bloomberg?
Yeah.
I don't think the president of the United States can enforce laws about how much soda you can drink.
I'm worried about
it. It's still up to the legislature. I think that he's probably, you know, people listening to me, Eric, there you go again. Well, you just, you know, leave me alone. I'm just assessing the field. The Democrats they're real, and they do have a primary. And hey, don't let me trigger you, Trumpers. I'm going to talk about them.
I don't want to hear about that.
As a field, I'm sorry. It's a thing, and it's really happening.
I don't want to hear it. La, 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 la.
Who's getting triggered now? But out of everybody, he'd probably be the best that they could nominate. I mean, he's really Joe Biden, but he hasn't lost his mind yet. I mean, basically. And he was a good governor, a good mayor of New York City, except for all that nanny state stuff where he tried to outlaw soda. And I think the taxes on cigarettes went through the roof. You know, so he's into that whole vice thing. But as president, you know, what can you do? Really? Stand up one day, give a speech at the State of the Union. No more soda. I'm outlawing soda.
I decided that no more sodas or cigarettes or guns.
Here's this guy.
Wake up, WSB.
Oh, sure, the wake up. I'm so sick and tired of people with the wake up on the left and the right. It's so condescending. Oh, if you don't agree with me, you're asleep. Get out of my face. Wake up. Are you woke? I don't know. Are you? Are you woke?
So he's trying to make WSB woke? Is that what he's trying to do?
Each side has their little wake-ups.
Yeah.
Wake up, WSB.
Go woke.
Get woke, WSB.
Go broke.
Y'all do it.
Y'all need to start talking about climate change. Get woke.
I'm so sick and tired. And that's why when something like last night happens with the missiles being shot into the Iraq bases. I never thought that this is going to be a wider war. I could be proven wrong. But my first thought was, can we handle this? All of us, Americans, the way that we converse with each other, the way that we, frolic in our hatred of each other. We love to hate each other. And it seems to be the most important thing. And we fool ourselves from both sides and say, no, it's in the name of the flag or the ideals of the country. But in reality, we just love hating the opposite side. And the way the rhetoric goes these days, where you don't even, I'm not going to debate that person. It would normalize them. You know, in that kind of atmosphere, do we have the ability to debate, talk about policies, how we get through something like this with Iran? What's the best way to go? That's what I worry about. And then I look at CNN's ratings and I say, well, there's hope. Nobody's watching. They still see it. I mean, there's nobody watching. In reality, there's nobody watching any of the 24-hour news networks. There's 330 million people in America. And if you combined all of the prime time, Fox, CNN, MSNBC, on a good night, you'll get up to like 13.5 million people. All of them.
Hey, The Bachelor on Monday brought in about 7 million people watching
it. That scares the hell out of me, too.
Only 7?
Yeah, surprisingly.
Yeah, but that's one show.
Yeah, that's true.
It takes 2.5 24-hour news networks to get to that.
And a specific age range, too, for it.
Yeah, people who you can sell more than CPAPs.
Well, I've got a delicious CPAP for that you can actually, it's connected
Sebastian
to your MyPillow. And if you need relief,
Sebastian Gorka's
take Relief Factor.
His Super Beat
Relief Factor Pillow CPAP machine.
So many things.
What's the other thing that, what's the
Audible?
No. For the things for the 24-hour news networks are always I can't think of the thing.
Bladder sling?
Catheter?
Catheters.
Mesh?
Yeah. No, catheters. They're big.
Ugh. Yeah.
So guess what? The Bachelor, with their 7 million people, they can actually sell Coca-Cola and Budweiser, too. They're actually active and living their lives. All right. So I don't think it's going to help Joe Biden. It's probably not going to hurt him. For some reason, Mayor Bottoms, maybe she just likes him. She's been on his side the whole time.
I'm glad that he changed the name of his tour. And hopefully he changed the name of his bus, too, because the We Know Joe tour, that's better. That's better than the Malarkey bus or whatever.
Was it the Malarkey bus?
No Malarkey. Or
the Baloney bus. I would have called that the Baloney bus.
Baloney bus. Then you slice it. It's baloney.
The No Malarkey. So you got rid of the No Malarkey.
We tested Malarkey, and everybody under 50 don't know what that means.
Okay. So what is the bus now?
Well, okay, so the tour itself is called We Know Joe. So hopefully they put that on the bus, too, because that's
catchy. We know Joe. He's kind of weird.
Yeah, hey, you brought your little 10-year-old daughter with you. Hey, come over here. I got to tell you a secret. Come on, let's go. I have to tell you a secret.
Hey, you know Joe. You should have brought her.
Hey, your hair smells great. Yeah. Wow, what are you? Hey, loves baby soft.
I'm blaming you.
He did that 3 times in the last 2 weeks.
What?
Said to a child, hey, I'm got a secret for you.
Well, he doesn't. I know
he doesn't, but it's weird looking.
Look, you can't control the guy.
I know.
But his instincts are, you can't control Trump either. But Trump has better instincts to his electorate, his base, and the wider electorate. And Biden just seems to be, really, it's kind of like Mr. Magoo running for president, isn't it? You remember Mr. Magoo?
Of course. I loved him.
He couldn't see. Yeah. You know, he'd bump into walls.
Yeah.
Somehow he would get to her. Listen, you don't remember Mr. Magoo, do you? It wasn't your time, Jared.
I do remember.
He
I think
there's a bumbling guy.
There's a remake of it.
He had a servant.
Yeah. In the cartoon, it was the voice of the
Jim Bacchus,
millionaire from Gilligan.
Oh, lovely.
That's a Joe Biden. He's like sleepwalking through a run for the presidency.
Hey, Corn Pop here. I'm looking for Joe Biden, that sorry sack of crap.
I gotta go.
Joe, this is your opportunity to stand your ground. What are we hearing?
Mr. Magoo theme.
Oh, that's Mr. Magoo.
Roadhog!
That's Joe Biden, Mr. Magoo. Blindly stumbling through a presidential run.
Get over here, Charlie. I need you to use karate on Corn Pop.
Oh, don't bring up Charlie. It's 2020. You can't bring up Charlie.
You couldn't bring up Charlie in 1970.
Yeah. Yeah, look up Charlie. I'm not going to get myself. Charlie was his
servant.
Servant. Yeah, a little bit of a stereotype there, Charlie.
A little.
What else you got for me?
The campaigns of Michael Bloomberg and President Trump each plan to spend $10 million for commercials during the Super Bowl.
Oh, yeah. Well, I heard Trump is doing a 30-second, so Bloomberg is going to do a full minute.
Yeah, well, I'm going to do half of that, and it's going to be a lot better than a minute because I'm going to have that movie ping.
Oh, you got that movie ping going. So the
Right.
All the movie trailers.
Wouldn't that be great? People look right up at their TV or their phone. We know they know we mean business.
That's right, because they'll look up and it's a commercial.
Oh, it's going to be great. It's going to be one of those really fantastic 30-second ads.
Yeah, look, $10 million, though, for 30. I have to tell you, the Super
Jump
Bowl.
Change.
For you, but outside. outside of, I know that a lot of people are watching. Over 100 million people are watching. Mm-hmm. And that's why they command so much money for 30 seconds or 60 seconds. But I would love to go back over the last 15 years. I'll bet you most companies that put out the money for that will tell you that it wasn't worth it. Now, I'm not talking about the big companies. I'm not talking about Amazon or Google or Budweiser, like I said before.
Doritos.
No, I'm talking about the wedding planner company that decides they're going to put all their eggs into the Super Bowl basket. I'd love to talk to a lot of these people and see if they got bang for the buck. I suppose it's you want to be in front of that many people if you're running for office, but I don't think you get $10 million of quality out of that. Hour 2 of the Von Haessler Doctrine begins now. And I continue my scandalous proposition this morning, which is, I do not believe that we are on the precipice of World War III. Sorry.
But the news said
Aaron Burnett.
Aaron Burnett. I've never seen her before. I just happened to be on when I got these push alerts, and I was on the internet TV, and I go to CNN. Oh, my goodness. Miss Grimm. You know, they don't even know how these kind of reporters, let's do a pundit panel, let's get your hot takes. So when you watch someone like Erin Burnett, she's trying so hard to get across this idea of credibility. You know, credible people don't smile in situations like this. Boy, look at my face. You can see that I understand the severity of what this nation is facing right now. But the truth is, 10 minutes after something happens, remember this, people. I don't care what the event is. I don't care how important it is. No one in the world knows what the fallout will be within 10 minutes. That whole notion is completely false. You should not run to your favorite 24-hour news network when a big event, like missiles being launched from Iran at U.S. forces in Iraq, you shouldn't even go there at that point. Because they have nothing, they have no ability. They have no ability because they're human beings just like you. And no human being within 10 minutes of hearing a story like that can come on television and tell you what's going to happen as a result. And when it's in their own interest to scare the hell out of you so you won't change the channel, you got the double down. It's the last place you need to go. When a big event happens, the last place you should go is 24-hour news. First of all, whichever one you choose, they know who you are and they know how to keep you. So Fox knows how to keep you if you choose them first. MSNBC knows how to keep you if you choose them first. And CNN is just as bewildered as to why you would choose them as any of the rest of us are.
Out front.
But they figure, yeah. What's Aaron Burnett
is out front.
Out front. Chris Hayes on MSNBC. All in.
Got Anderson Cooper 360.
360.
Wolf Blitzer, the Situation Room.
The Situation Room.
The situation is grim.
Am I the only one that has internet TV? The way the guides are, but maybe it's even that way, maybe it's satellite and the rest. But if you look down at all these people on the side where their show is, there's a picture of them. And they all look really important.
Oh, yeah.
They're always like pondering something. Like, have their arms crossed.
I'm thinking about things for you.
They're pondering. Chris Hayes, all in.
You ever watch that show?
Is he the one that doesn't like the hammering?
No, that's Lawrence O'Donnell.
Oh, okay. All right.
No, Chris Hayes is the guy that looks like he doesn't like testosterone.
Oh, is he the guy with the glass? Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's a little kind of pencil necky kind of dude.
Yeah.
He's all in. So you don't understand this. You haven't sacrificed like Chris Hayes.
Okay.
Because when it comes to the events of the day, sir, you are not all in.
Oh. Well, I'm out front.
Well, if you were all in, let me tell you, it would show on your face as well.
Well,
it's a sacrifice. He's sacrificing himself. But they all look like, if you look at them on the internet guide thing, it looks like they all have just released a new album, and that's their album cover. It's the kind of thing, like...
I looked at my wife last night.
Joan Baez, Diamonds and Rust.
Why can't we have BBC News or something like that?
Well, you do have BBC News.
You do? On cable?
Well, on anything, almost. Well. You should have BBC News. But you know what you get from BBC News? All the climate stuff, constantly.
Fox News is guilty of this, too. I'm looking at...
Fox News is guilty of almost everything you can imagine.
I changed that one quicker than I changed CNN last night, because Tucker was just staring at some guy.
Well, Tucker doesn't like the people in the military... In the permanent government, he calls it the deep state, whatever.
Yeah.
There are people who have been wanting to go to war with Iran for a very long time. That's true.
Right.
That's true. But like you say, when something like this happens and you tune in, so what was going on with Tucker Carlson? A bunch of people with opinions.
Right.
But the truth is, you can't have a legitimate opinion 10 minutes after something that big happens. And if you did, and you were right most of the time, well, you should be president. I mean, you actually know how things are going to land? You think the neocons didn't think they knew how things were going to land when they walked us into Iraq? Turned out, they were wrong. And they had all the data and the facts and everything, more so than anybody you're going to see talking on
your world with
All
Neil
out.
Cavuto.
Well, that's why I go to 4chan and Twitter. That's where I get my
news. Oh, yeah, that's even better, right?
But you can. You find real links and you read news stories.
Yeah, but it's also you're being pushed and pulled in different ways there. But what people don't seem to understand is what's killing reportage in this country is the hot take. Mm. I can't get on the air unless I have a beginning, middle, end point of view, what's going to happen, and I have to do it within 10 minutes. And if I want to sell that book I spent so much time paying somebody else to write, I better get on TV.
TikTok.
Yeah, you want just boring reporting.
Well, look, you know what? I would say I'll push back against that as well. What okay. I want is reporting with context. There's nothing wrong with a reporter having a style. There's nothing wrong with taking the facts, fitting them into a wider context. But, and it doesn't matter whether you think people who hate Trump are right to hate Trump. I'm not even, or if you love Trump so much, there's no doubt that most people in the media don't like Trump. And they're on the record as saying they don't like Trump. Maybe they're right, maybe they're wrong. I'm not arguing that. What I'm saying is I can't receive news about his actions in the Middle East from people who are on the record as saying it's an abomination that he's the president of the United States. That's a fact. If history shows that they were 100% right in their resistance to this president, it wouldn't change the fact that I can't get good reportage out of these people concerning an action this president took because it's being seen through their eyes, which they've let me know. We think it's nearly criminal that this guy became president of the United States. So they give up their legitimacy in that. So it's the, first of all, in situations like this, assume the very worst thing isn't what's going to happen. Every once in a while it does. But most of the time it doesn't. So when you see what happened last night and then you turn on the 24-hour news networks and everybody's getting ginned up and you go to Tucker Carlson and he's against the war and then Sean Hannity comes on and says, well, we got to hit him hard and blah, blah, blah. And then over at CNN, hey, we warned you. We told you this guy. They don't care about the issue. They care about, excuse me, do you not have a mute button?
I'm so sorry. I thought that I, so sorry. I thought I had muted.
No, I really think it helped drive my political point home.
That's right. You know what? I'm allergic to really good commentary.
That's Autumn's, that's her version of amen,
yeah,
brother, is what she meant to say.
Hallelujah.
Preach. Amen, brother.
That was from yesterday. That was Autumn's McConnell.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
Well, we need this sort of lighthearted, lighthearted mood. Yeah, if you find me getting too much, the next time I'm up on my soapbox and I'm really getting really full of myself and I'm ranting and I'm raving about something, take it one step further. Just fart.
Yeah.
Okay. Just you got it.
Literally break the air. All right.
That's Tim's.
Hey.
I don't know. We haven't even started it.
No, we haven't even opened the mailbag.
Oh, but is that what we're doing? We're doing mailbag. I went on and on about. I'm just saying, people. The world is the real world. It's not the world you see on your screens. Remember. All right, do this.
It's Mailbag Monday. We've got the open mics, Facebook messages, and emails we've collected from the week.
Were there any other good names? All in.
Oh, I was looking at the Fox lineup. You've got, let's see.
I want a show called Right Here with Eric Von Haessler.
Yeah.
Your World with Neil Cavuto.
Your World.
They've got The Story with Martha McCallum.
The Story. Now, did she do one story? No. It's a lie.
The Ingraham.
And don't forget Hardball. Hardball, you've been there from the very beginning.
Don't forget Hardball. We've been talking about Trump and how crazy he is. We're going to do that tonight. Why is he attacking Iran? We're going to find out.
The Last Word.
The Last
Lawrence
Word.
Lawrence O'Donnell.
Yeah.
Stop the hammering.
I want Right Here with Eric Von Haessler.
Right here.
We're doing the show Right Here.
So Right Here?
With Eric Von Haessler.
Ooh, that's so Jared, Right Here Right Now.
So Right Here Right Now is the Jared Yamamoto.
That's my show. Yeah. That's my 11 o'clock at night.
What's it
show.
Called? The Onan Network?
O-A-N.
Oh, yeah.
One American Network.
Hey, tune in to us. You're going to love our programming.
So
something for everybody here on Onan News. Wear shoes.
Hey, if you like, if you're comfortable with your own company. And you're right wing. Onan News is where you want to be.
Mine's called Hachoo!
You don't even know.
Autumn Fisher.
Do you know, you're laughing like you know, Jared, but you know, do you know what that word means?
I don't think so.
Onan.
Well, what do you do when you're by yourself, alone, completely, no cameras?
Laundry.
No one's
sleep.
Is that it?
Laundry.
Laundry. What is that? OAN? What is that?
One America News.
One America.
Yeah.
So it means everybody in America agrees with what's said on OAN.
Correct.
Yep.
So they're bringing us together by pointing out who amongst us is not up to snuff politically.
Exactly.
Bringing us together by pointing fingers at people they're calling, I don't know, treasonous or whatever. Yeah. Traitors.
Traitors.
And this is pulling us together as one America.
Yeah.
With their network. What is that on? I don't even have that on my cable thing. And I have Cheddar. I don't even know what that is.
Cheddar? Cheddar is kind of more tech news. Kind of more lifestyle.
Yeah, I got Cheddar and I got Newsy.
Newsy's fun.
But I don't have OAN.
Did you stay up late enough to watch?
Newsy's got a bunch of little kids trying to sell newspapers.
Yeah, they got those funny.
Extra, extra.
Those cool little hats.
You watch the 11th Hour with Brian Williams?
The 11th Hour. It's the 11th Hour of his career.
I'm Brian Williams. It's the 11th Hour.
Well, look at that guy. He doesn't have enough money. Every day he has to get humiliated because he made up some facts about some stupid story.
He was supposed on the space shuttle.
He was supposed to be. That guy can't get the job he deserves, and there are no Me Too allegations.
I know. He was going to be the next anchor.
Oh, he was the big one. He was the only one out of all of the networks that really had what was left in charisma and whatever to get to actually do it. I think if he had been at NBC Nightly News for the last 10 years, he probably would be on top. But you know what? You made up some goofy story that turned out to be a lie, and now just go relax. Is it that important to be humiliated every night on MSNBC at 11 o'clock?
He can host the Daily Ledger on One America News or Tipping Point with Brian Williams.
I want to know what's on Cheddar, because the next big show is going to be right here with Eric Von Haessler. You know, that Erin Burnett, I just, whenever you see her, her face says, I am so exasperated by this president. Just like, I cannot believe I have to come here and talk about these things again today. But all right, okay. Miss Burnett, can we comb your hair?
I'm exacerbated.
I am just absolutely exasperated, not exacerbated.
Are those two different words?
They're two different words.
With meanings?
Exasperated.
Mm-hmm.
She's had enough.
Okay.
Exacerbated is when something is built it bigger, took it further. Exacerbated. Is that right?
Yes.
I exacerbated once. But I was
on the news network. I left a mess.
That's what Jared does when he's alone.
Yeah, I was. No, he does his laundry.
I sleep.
Oh, right. Sorry.
He exacerbates clean laundry. Is Erin Burnett, now I'm fascinated because I never watched these channels. And the only reason I came across is because I was on the internet when this all broke yesterday. I'm like, the first thing I saw was CNN. So I went there. And you said, the girl with the dark hair. I was like, no, she has light hair now.
Yeah, she lightened it.
Is Burnett a brunette in
she
reality?
She is, yes.
Okay.
Irish.
And now you could ask, hey, do they talk about male reporters this way?
Yeah.
And the answer, of course, is yes.
I haven't heard you do it.
Oh, how often have I said things about the unbelievable perfectness of Fred Blankenship?
You do describe him first as tall.
Tall.
Handsome.
I say that he's
smells
not.
Smells great.
I think that he was assembled. He wasn't born. He was assembled in the handsome factory somewhere in South Korea, I believe.
I want to take a tour of that factory.
Autumn, she likes his news profile.
Well, this open micer might set you off a little bit. He's a little critical of Mr. Blankenship.
Hey, Eric. Randy from Greenville, South Carolina. Since I'm not from Atlanta, I don't watch WSB at night. And I just saw a billboard with a picture of Fred Blankenship on it. Let me ask you a question, since you've seen Fred Blankenship in person. Is his head just a little too big for his body? Just need to know.
All right. First of all.
How dare you?
Yes.
How dare you?
All right, let me explain something to you. Where's he from?
Greenville.
South Carolina?
I imagine.
All right. Everybody's head's bigger when you're on a billboard. Because billboards make everything bigger. You understand? When you go see a Bond film, his head's not really that big when you're in the movie theater.
Is he really 12 feet tall?
And secondly, the answer's no. Fred Blankenship is perfect in every physical way. Man, here. IV drip of this Red Bull this morning. Didn't get enough sleep last night.
What were you watching?
I actually stayed up. I decided that there was enough separation. After I saw, you know, Miss Grimface over on CNN, I said, okay, well, this has happened. These missiles have been launched. And, you know, I can walk away for 12 hours because I don't know. There's no sense in sitting here. So I decided that there had been enough separation. I actually sat down and watched our video Christmas special on YouTube.
Mm.
And, man, it's quite good. I had to get separation because, you know, when you're editing that together, after a while, you don't even know what's up or what's down. You're just like, okay, deadline, put it out. But I watched it, and it was very good. I know, I'm aware of the fact that not many people are going to watch something on YouTube for an hour, but I don't care about that. Everybody did a great job. And when I was watching it again, I didn't, first of all, Greg was fantastic. Everybody was great. But I didn't realize how great Dave Baker was when I was there as Santa Claus. He was just fantastic. So, I don't know, it's still there. It'll be there forever, right?
Yeah, you can watch it on the Von Haessler Doctrine YouTube page, and we posted it on our Facebook page, too. So it's right there on the Von Haessler Doctrine Facebook page
as well.
A lot
of, you know, I think I'm really proud of us, you guys, and myself. Mostly me, but you guys as well. I'm really proud of us because, you know, there's a lot of humor in there. There's a lot of stuff going on in that hour. And when you look at someone like... who's the guy at NBC, used to be on SNL late night? He's where Conan used to be.
Oh, Jimmy.
Not Jimmy. No, the Seth Meyers.
Oh, Seth Meyers, yes.
That guy comes out and does a monologue or whatever he does. And, you know, maybe 3 out of 10 jokes work. He's probably got a staff of like 15 writers to do that sort of thing. This is just us going, hey, this would be cool. That'd be cool. That'd be fun. Let's put it together. And it comes out really, I think... very well done. Our version of a Christmas television special. And so I'm proud of mostly me, but you guys as well. And I want to let you know that. But yeah, so it's available with the Von Haessler Doctrine. Do we have a YouTube page now?
Yes, Von Haessler Doctrine YouTube page.
I'm trying. You see in my office. I'm changing my office around.
Well, I don't think you ordered all the right pieces.
No, I ordered I ordered a glass top desk.
Uh-huh.
I won't say yet who I ordered it from because mistakes are made, and I don't want to be. I want to give people time to do the right thing. But I ordered this glass top desk. Now, if I said to you, Tim Andrews, and I just quiz you,
okay.
And I said if you could choose one part of a glass top desk that would be the most important element of a glass top desk, what would you guess that part would be?
The little rubber things that keep the legs from sliding.
No.
Yeah. That's what I was going to think.
The glass top.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, that's important, but so, that's a given.
No, you think it was a given. Jared and I opened the box yesterday for my glass top desk, and everything is there except for the glass.
So you forgot to order it.
No, I
didn't. Yeah, order it from a place that starts with I and ends with...
No.
Yeah.
No. Excuse me.
Yeah,
excuse me.
Get him, Tim.
You saw, Jared, you were there. You saw the instructions. Is there not a glass top in the instructions in the box that we pulled out?
I think the best part about us opening the box is where we're looking at the diagram, right? And it's clearly a rectangle glass. And yeah. You are convinced... that within the styrofoam that there is a desktop.
It's got to be in here.
It's
got to be.
I'm like, Eric, there's no way it's in that styrofoam.
How the hell do they send something to your house? It's a glass top desk without the glass. At that point, it's just, I don't know, what do you call those things? Like
stilts.
Yeah. Those A-frame things. Yeah. That's all it is.
It's a saw
bunch
horse.
Of beams. It's a sawhorse. A bunch of saw horses and some cross beams.
Well, you can saw wood in there.
Was it delivered to WSB?
No,
or was
it was delivered to my house.
All right,
I brought
it's at
it
your
here.
House then.
No, I went back home. This thing was supposed to be delivered on Monday. It got delivered early. I think it was there by Saturday. And so I thought yesterday, we didn't open it up till yesterday. I thought, okay, well, maybe it comes, the second part comes. No.
Might be a porch pirate.
But they only took one part?
Yarr,
yeah, he's like,
oh, glass.
Man.
Yeah.
I need some glass.
I don't need the saw. I need the glass.
Did you order it or did your wife order it?
I ordered
well,
it.
Well, see, there's the problem.
Why's the
Let
problem?
Let me see. I want to send me the username
thing.
And password for wherever you ordered it from. I'm looking into this.
All right. Will you take care of it? Because I hate calling customer service. I don't even know what it is. To me, the internet is like this machine on the other side of the world. I just order things. And they show up at my door. I don't know what to do after that. I'm supposed to talk to somebody now? Hey, excuse me. I expected there to be glass in my glass top desk. Excuse me.
That's an extra $47.
But it's not, because you are right that it probably should have been sent separately because it's rectangular. But as you saw in the instructions from the box that we got, in the instructions, there is a glass top.
You clearly see it. And Sam on our Facebook page says the glass was just too clear for any of us to see it.
Yeah, it's like Wonder Woman's plane.
Oh, that's what it is. Maybe it's in there.
Yeah.
You need a laser beam. Go in your office, close, turn off all the lights, shine a laser beam, and see where it starts reflecting.
Yeah, first, I got to get a smoke machine.
Yeah.
So make sure to get everything so I can get all the reflections.
Yes.
So I'm trying to, because I want to do YouTube things. I've got an idea for an idea. You know what that is? That's why I don't really know what I want to do.
It's a concept.
It's a concept that's an empty concept.
Should I have a brainstorming session?
There's no details. No, I don't believe in brainstorming.
Hey, let's get together for 10 minutes and hack out some ideas. Come on. Hey, you go. Hey, what's your top 10 idea?
My idea, my empty idea is I want to do a 3 to 5 minute daily video that we can put on YouTube, but I don't want it to be in any way, I don't want it to be anything that's on the radio show or on the podcast. So I'm trying to think of some kind of very quick thumbs up, thumbs down, this, that kind of thing that I can do that'll be interesting. Eric's hot takes. Something along those lines.
No, we don't like that one.
Yeah, so... we're not going to do weapon talk, Alan.
America.
I've often said you can't say America without saying Eric.
That's right.
But then again, I don't want to be pontificating. I want it to be a fun thing that people would want to watch.
First video. Why don't you get your glass tops when you order glass top tests?
That video is done. It's in the pipeline. It's ready to go. All I have to do is pull the trigger on that one.
Look at me, I'm Eric.
Are we still doing mail?
Yeah, I've got some more mail.
Have we done any mail? We've been doing mail for an hour
open
now.
Mic and
God, you're the worst producer of all time.
Sam responded in real time to the glass thing, so he was helping us out there.
How do you know it's a him? There's plenty of Samantha.
Wow. All right, you know what, Sam?
Somebody smack him in the head with a calendar. He obviously doesn't realize it's 2020.
That's a problem.
Oh!
This is how I'm including him. Hashtag you too.
Now.
Yeah, I'm looking at you. You too.
There are a lot of people that
want
to weigh in
No, not you two.
Not me,
the band. And not you who, that weird chocolatey
stand
thing.
Stand down edge.
Watery. Anybody like that? You who? Is that still around?
I used to drink you who.
That's horrible.
And then I turned into an adult and I went, chocolate water.
No,
Jared, you remember what it tasted like? It doesn't taste like
that. Horrible.
It doesn't taste like chocolate milk.
It's water.
Water and chocolate.
Yeah.
It's disgusting.
It's like Gene Simmons putting water in his cereal.
Hey,
gross.
That happened while we were on, and a lot of people are talking about that.
Yeah.
And I didn't watch it because I can't watch people in their 70s eat cereal.
Clearly.
I don't know if he's in his 70s, but I don't like to watch old people eat cereal.
And I'm eating adult cereal.
Yeah, what are you eating?
Oreos.
Man? Yeah.
Oreos cereal.
So Gene Simmons from Kiss.
Yes.
It's a big thing. This shows you how starved for entertainment we are. While I was away, this became a big thing that he puts ice in his cereal.
Who doesn't want their milk to stay cold?
Now, I agree with that. Milk cannot be too cold. I like cold milk. But how long does it take this guy to eat his cereal?
Well, I like to let it get soggy.
How long does it take to eat breakfast? Eating a bowl of cereal is like a 5-minute time span.
Gene Simmons eats one piece of cereal per spoon. I have to have a ratio of ice cold milk to just one little piece of cereal.
What a diva. All right, what else is in the mail?
Got more people weighing
shredded wheat. I don't understand.
Yeah, Paul Stanley, you don't eat it that way, right?
Well, no, I eat good cereal because I like to, you know, I like to stay regular.
That's right. So you're shredded wheat.
Shredded wheat.
I remember when I was a kid, shredded wheat. It looks like it's going to taste so good, and then you eat it. It's awful. That's way too healthy.
You can't just
throw sugar on top of healthy and expect me to enjoy it as a kid.
More people are weighing in on Glassgate, Eric.
The fact that my glass top desk came with no glass top.
Yes, Scott says, this is why you shouldn't go modern. Glass top was probably some hipster environmentalist code word for sit on a yoga mat with a clipboard.
No, you saw the damn thing. It's a piece of glass.
No, there's no standing desk movement that doesn't include the top of a desk.
Yeah, and it's not a standing desk. I tried to get one, but you could try to get a standing desk that's made of glass. Oh, my God, you're talking about thousands of dollars.
Yeah, it's a big desk.
I'm no Clark Howard, but I don't. Yeah, this big desk. There's an obvious monopoly.
Yep. You can make your own desk, you know? You go like...
How long do you think that's going to take me to make my own desk?
First off, shabby chic with a door, like an old antique door.
There's some beautiful trees here in Sherwood Forest.
No, not like that, Jared. Yeah. You go out and you scavenge and you make, this is my cool desk.
No, I don't need that. I don't want a cool desk. I mean, I want a desk that's sleek and says, hey, this guy's got class. It's modern. This guy's got that touch of modern, those people. Hey, drink champagne from your watch. Touchofmodern.com. A million things you just don't need. Scuba dive in your own dishwasher. Touchofmodern.com. Hey, it's 2020. I like that, too. You hear a lot of that, where people... Yeah. Yeah, do people realize that the calendar is not an argument?
It's the current year, my friend.
Yeah. Hey, people like say something, they make a political point to you. Hey, it's 2020.
Okay.
When did the calendar become a political argument?
That thing you liked yesterday on December 31st?
Hey, it's not December 31st anymore.
It's January 1st.
Yeah.
2020.
Hey, it's 2020.
Yeah, leave it back where it belongs.
Women could be astronauts, too.
Yeah.
I kind of knew that in 2019, but okay. What? Women can be astronauts too?
Exactly.
Outrageous.
Does that offend you?
Oh, yeah. I'm right there. You can start your article in Vulture or Vox. Haessler just can't seem to deal with a world where women... Let me get this straight.
Does it scare you?
Oh, it frightens the hell out of me.
You know what? I didn't have to ask my dad for permission to go to space.
But do you want to know why it frightens me? Because that means that you're taking a seat that maybe I could have had, and I could have gone to outer space.
That's right. You need to take a seat that's not here.
These women are taking our astronaut jobs.
Well, guess what? I'm going to be the first former Olympic winner to go into space. Also, the first woman to go on a space tourism flight.
Caitlyn Jenner.
Isn't that amazing? Hey, you know, I'm out there on the forefront for women.
Girls and stuff can do it, too.
Yeah, girl power.
Girls and stuff.
Isn't there a thing, there's a story, Georgia is one of the states that's suing, or however they're doing it, passing laws, trying to make it illegal for guys...
To go to space.
Teenage guys, no.
Oh, okay.
To become girls and then compete against other girls. This is very controversial. Here's my challenge on the whole thing. You show me the one girl who becomes a guy at the age of 17 and then starts breaking all the records in all the male sports. And if you could show me one example of that happening, then I will then agree with you that it is, in fact... 2020.
The Von Haessler Doctrine.
They have such a beautiful chemistry.
Making listeners laugh every day.
The world could use a little more of that these days.
9 to noon on 95.5 WSB. Atlantis News and Talk.
I've got weird Lou Dobbs hair this morning. I actually forgot to wash my hair last night.
Wow.
I bathed. Just after I got out, I realized, you've got to wash your hair. I said, one day.
You didn't have an extra 15 seconds to spare?
I was in the mood. I was ready to go to bed.
Yeah.
You know, I was in the, and I just realized, I forgot to.
You were supposed to have a haircut yesterday, weren't you?
Yeah, but I didn't have enough money on me.
Uh-huh.
So
you don't have a credit card?
Place I go to, it's all cash.
It's one of those places.
Yeah, so I stopped
at the front.
I don't know what they're really doing there, but they don't take cards.
Smuggling pandas.
So I suppose I could have stopped at an ATM. I was looking for a reason not to. I just looked at my wallet and went, only got 10 bucks. I'll do it tomorrow. But now I don't want to do it because I know I have Lou Dobbs hair and it wasn't clean. So now I'm going to do it on Thursday.
Well, they'll wash it for you.
No, not this place.
Oh. What kind of barbershop do you go to?
This old world barbershop, man. It's just clippers and, you know, some scissors. Lotion.
Guy smoking while he's cutting your hair?
No, it could be. No, it's one of those places where even you just sit there and then whoever's next you get.
Okay.
Like, you just sit there and you don't care. Look at this hair. What do I care? I need some sort of specialist on my hair. Hey, how do you want it? Just make it look as much not like Lou Dobbs' hair as possible. Okay, I'll give you what I got. So
who's Lou Dobbs?
Doesn't everybody know who Lou Dobbs is? All right, have we done any mail during this mail segment?
We did a little bit. There are people responding to your glass table.
Is it true that... Greg Russ is mad that I pushed his cat's review?
He is upset, but he'll understand because the president's coming on.
President's about to speak. We're going to go to that.
It stunk. There you go.
Look, we got the president has already given us his
garbage
cat's review. We're going to do the cat's review tomorrow.
Yeah.
Tell that kid to settle down. Remind him that it's 2020 after all.
He did say he'll be on the podcast 30, and then we'll carry, obviously, Trump's speech live here on 95.5 WSB.
Oh, look at you. Hour 3 of the Von Haessler Doctrine begins right now. As Sabrina just told you, the president is about to speak, but right now it's just an empty podium. So we will fill the time between now and the president. We're still doing mail here. By the way, and I don't want you to go any deeper on this, but I am offended, sir, Tim Andrews, when you ask me, because I'm upset that the glass top didn't come to my glass top desk,
mm-hmm.
and you ask me if I shared fetishes with Danny Thomas, and the answer is no.
Oh, okay, good. I'm glad you clarified that. You.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
you have more mail for
us?
Well,
I was going to say, I have a direct line to President Trump. He's going to come on at 11:15.
No, because that was your prediction.
That was my prediction.
It's now 11:08 on Peachtree.
Yeah.
So we'll see how right you are. But rest assured, as soon as the president begins speaking, we will stop speaking. Why are you pointing at the... People know that they're already listening to 95.5 WSB. Why would I have to tell them that?
It's just music.
What's wrong with you?
95.5 WSB.
Great. Jared thinks it's the old days when you actually had it.
I need a new producer.
Yeah. They don't need know, Jared.
Yeah, he's giving me the story about how in Finland they only have to work 4 days a week, 30 hours. And he wants days off. He feels like he's overworked.
Finland,
you
want
to go work in Finland? Finland. I gotta listen to people talk. Oh, you know, in Finland, they're very enlightened, and they only work 40. And you see the prime minister, who's like 27 or something.
They're all women. All the top ministers are women.
Yeah, they're like 27 years old. Well, people need more time to live their life. Maybe people like their jobs. Has anybody ever thought about this? That you could actually enjoy going to work? It is a possibility. Finland, I'm glad you're so enlightened with your four-day work week and your 30-hour work week. My guess is you will never produce a Steve Jobs. My guess is nothing will be innovated out of Finland. People don't understand. Steve Jobs and the first group of people around him worked for a very long time at 90 hours a week. That was 40 years ago. Now, depending on the markets on any given day, it's the biggest company in the world. That don't happen in Finland with four-day weeks. And they did this in France for a while. I think they got rid of it. Because what happens is it puts pressure on you as a person who wants to work 40 or more hours a week. You become a threat. Hey, what are you showing everybody up for? Hey, who do you think you are with your four? Wait, did you work 50 hours this week?
Well, I just had to get things finished.
Yeah. You're going to be finished, pal.
Why? I just won't work.
There's some great things that have been invented in Finland, guys. Yeah,
name the last thing. That's what I want to know is, what was the year? And I guarantee you there was not a four-day work week, 30-hour maximum.
Finnish farmer Arvi Lehti invented the safety reflector for use on his horse carts during long, dark winters.
Yeah, you know what? No one else would have thought of that. If it weren't for that guy, the idea of some sort of tape-like substance that would reflect light... No one would have thought of it. How did that guy get the credit? I guarantee you 900 other people thought of that at the same time. 51% personal income tax rate, I'm told by the great Alan Hunt.
Hey, they invented the Suomi KP-31, which is a submachine gun used during World War II.
Yeah, because they were in war.
They also invented...
You know what happens in war? You don't have 30-hour work weeks. It doesn't work that way.
You work.
Remember the computer program Linux? You know, instead of Microsoft Linux. Or Apple?
Yeah, he's from... He.
Yes.
What's his name?
Linus Torvald.
Linus Torvald. Is he from Finland?
I believe so.
I thought he was Swedish or something. Or Swiss.
I don't know.
Do you get the Swiss and the Swedes mixed up as
sometimes,
I do?
Sometimes, yes.
It's just because of the SW.
Yes.
And they're really close to each other.
Well, they're not really that close to each other.
In my mind, they are.
Okay.
I've never been over there. And I don't look at maps.
Switzerland's closer to Italy and
that's
Spain.
What I was saying. Yeah, I know that. Okay. What do you think? You're telling me something I don't know?
Hey, they invented the electric sail.
The electric sail.
Yeah, Nokia phones. Remember those?
Well, Nokia is just a company. They didn't invent it.
The first internet browser with graphical user interface.
What was that, Netscape?
Finnish. It doesn't say which one. It's just like some university.
I just want to see what they're gonna invent in the future.
Fish car scissors.
That's a game that me and my little brother used to play in the back seat.
Fish car scissors.
the rescue toboggan.
You need that in Finland.
Bubble chairs.
You know what they invented? If they didn't invent it, they certainly perfected it. Alcoholism. It's a country full of... Do you know this about Finland? It's freezing all the time.
Yeah.
And people just get... They just drink. You would too. I mean, now you got all that extra time on your hand. Hey, you know the best thing to tell a country full of alcoholics? We're cutting 10 hours out of your work week. That'll work out just fine.
One last invention?
Yes.
Angry Birds.
Yeah, okay. They got some people with the... I'll give you that.
It does say on Culture Trip that they invented...
Wait a minute. They're responsible for the movie? Because that sucked.
No, just the game.
It says they invented ice skates, too. That's a big one.
When? In 1702? Give me something that I use today.
You know, ice skate?
Oh, I can't. I could never ice skate. I could never understand it. Some people, my mother would date every once in a while. I don't know why it was. I'll take your kid ice skating.
Oh, the stepfather to be?
Yeah, the guy who I don't really know. And yeah. 3 weeks later, I never see him again.
My mom had guys like, hey, you want to play catch? Nah.
Yeah. Well, catch, I could understand. Ice skating, I don't get it. I know it's like, okay, strapping blades on my feet. And how are my ankles not supposed to pop? I never understood. I could never stand up on the damn things.
Couldn't? Just got to get going.
Yeah, I, you know, the concept, I can understand it, but I could not do it. I can't stand on knives and walk across ice. I'm sorry.
That's why you skate. You don't walk.
I'll bet you this guy. You know, when Jared, he's such a millennial, when he ice skates, he probably has to be, and we have to have hot chocolate, and we got to put a thing, and we got to have the whole ice skating experience. Because
the best part is by the end of the day, I figured out how to do it backwards again. I usually can't do that right away because you only go ice skating like once every year or
25, 30 years.
What do you say? When's the last time you were ice skating?
I was 10.
Yeah, the last time is the last time there was a boyfriend that. Yeah, I was probably 13.
They have all these ice skating.
I never ice skated. I could get out there and my just break my ankles.
But you guys, there's ice skating rinks all around town. There's one in Kennesaw. There's one at Atlantic Station.
Well, good for
one at Centennial.
That's nice. Hey, look, if people like to strap knives onto their feet and try to walk across the ice, good for them. I'm not going to call for a law that says it should be banned. But why would I do it? It's like skiing. Hey, man, I'm going skiing.
Oh, that's a blast. Come on. Don't hate on skiing.
I've never gone skiing, ever.
Let me just say this. I've never known a group of skiers where somebody from that group isn't in a cast for a long period of time. I've never known somebody who loves skiing who didn't see a cast at one point. And then in reality, I look at skiing as a controlled fall. Why would you do it? It's controlled.
The views.
I'm falling. Well, go to the top and look.
Well, but you got to get down. What better way to go down?
You can
race your buddy if you're going down.
It's a controlled fall. To me, that does not seem like a good time. Falling is something I try to avoid.
You're a NASCAR guy, right?
What, meaning I own a team?
No, or, you like NASCAR, though, right? Like racing, right?
I do.
Think
like,
of it as a race down the mountain.
Yeah, but it's that race.
That's a competition.
NASCAR's on the ground.
By the way, yeah.
I mean, no, skiing's on the ground, but never mind.
What you're saying is more like rally racing.
Yeah, exactly. You're going
That's a competition. You know, I can like things that are a competition. I don't go play NFL football. I get killed. But I watch it.
Cross-country skiing, Eric, is good. It's good for you.
Yeah, but then you get all hot and sweaty, and you lose your brain. You don't know where you are.
Layers.
No, and you're out in the middle of nowhere. You forgot to tell a buddy. The next thing you know, they just find you.
Bears are eating you.
1,000 years later, you're put in some museum.
This guy was a disc jockey in Atlanta, Georgia.
Yes.
He was frozen in a mountain.
What's wrong with just staying at home?
Watching skiing on television.
And I love, during the Winter Olympics, I'll watch that.
Those jumps?
I know, when those people jump like that, I wanted to go, I forgot that they did that, was it an X Games thing?
Yeah.
At SunTrust? I would like to have seen, because they put a ski thing in and they did all the hot dog and stuff. But when you see that stuff in the Olympics, you ever think to yourself, how do you get started? Like, I understand I'm looking at somebody who knows what they're doing, and they're going 9 million miles an hour, and they go up the chute, and they flip 90 times in the air, and they land. But how do you get? What's the first time you do that? What does that look like? Do you start on a really teeny tiny?
Yeah, you start on the bunny slope and then work your way.
But I'm not talking about skiing. I'm talking about these people who do these. You know, like they, or the half pipe, like those guys, the and gals who just like fly through the air and are just seeing how they're just soaring through the air. I can mentally understand. Well, they can do that now. You know, they're like 19 years old or something, do that. But how does that get started? How far do you fly the first time? How do you not die learning how to do that? That's what I want to know.
Breaking every bone in your body.
How is it possible that you're not Evel Knievel at Caesar's Palace when you start doing that?
Well, you start small and the snow
is... What, hop?
Yeah, and the snow...
You start with a hop? Okay, that went all right. One foot. I'm good at it. Let me push this out to 3 feet. Is that how it works?
They probably changed the angle, the trajectory of launch when you start on one that's not as steep and maybe only go 10 feet and then keep building up.
But don't you think that must feel amazing?
Oh,
when you see those guys are just like, they're flying through the air.
And they're confident that they're not going to kill themselves, so it's doubly awesome to look around while you're doing that.
I think it'd be more fun if you thought you were going to die.
Why?
You'd realize I really have to take this in. I really need to appreciate
this.
This
is my last job ever. I end up on the Wide World of Sports promo reel.
Do they start on things like with Nerf stuff and things like that indoors? Like you start flipping and you flip into a box of Nerf footballs or something?
Probably depends on what region you're from. Like, I mean, if you're growing up in Colorado, I mean, why... You have all
but
these
still,
beautiful
my point
mountains.
Is, you're not going to start off jumping. What is that called? Ski jump? What is it when they're just flying through the air like that? This is like, they just go downhill off a slope, and then they put their ski, they get aerodynamic, and they just fly for like 12 seconds or something.
Ski jumping.
So my question to you, Jared, is, how do you get started without killing yourself?
Just start small.
Start small?
Yeah, start small and then work your way up.
Jump 5 feet.
Yeah, just...
You think it's... Okay, now I'm getting Alan Hunt here. He's answering my questions.
That's water skiing.
I know, but you would learn on water. And believe me, water is like concrete if you're going fast enough and you're at the wrong angle. All right, the president claims he's going to speak in a few minutes. When he does, we will take you there live. What did you just say to me? It annoyed me.
Talking about the... shirt that you have there?
Well, no, I have this. Can I say about shirts? Too many words on shirts. This is a new thing with lots of words on shirts.
Yeah, I don't have time to read your shirt.
I mean, to me, it's three words. Keep on trucking.
Yeah.
That gets the message across.
Nike.
Something along those lines. But somebody sent us a shirt. Do we know who this is?
It was a very nice listener, but I can't remember the name.
I'm sure they're a great listener, but let me very quickly, and as soon as Trump comes out to speak, we will go to him. So anytime I say the word two, it's the number two on this shirt. And anytime I say and, it's the plus sign. And anytime I say into, it's the letter N followed by the number two. This is on the front of the shirt. It's time to turn gangstocrats and rethuglicans back into Democrats and Republicans, then back into Americans. And then there's a hashtag, Taborous Intelligence. Isn't the concept of a hashtag that is real easy? Yes.
Normally.
You know, Wednesday Wisdom or some kind of Thursday throwback.
I voted for Hillary.
Yeah, today says I voted for Hillary.
Oh, why? Because of the Iran thing?
Yeah.
This is how stupid people are. What was her vote on the Iraq war? Yes. Why did she make that vote? She calculated that she wanted to be president one day, and at that time she thought it would be good. Kind of backfired on her. But it was all about calculation. Well, the idea that Hillary Clinton, I'm supposed to believe now, was the anti-war in the Middle East candidate, I don't remember that.
She's into peace.
She changed her ways now.
She's all sorts of peace. I'm into peace, she's into peace, and we share the pieces.
It's all about the pieces. I see people walking up to the podium. All right, breaking news. Well, I don't know about everybody else, but that's exactly what I wanted to hear from the president. I don't want to pat myself on the back, but did I not basically tell you at 9 o'clock this morning exactly what the proper response would be?
You called that.
Right? Were you listening in?
Yes.
Even right to doubling down on the economic sanctions. So exactly, it played out exactly as what I thought and not what CNN was telling me last night, that we were on the edge of World War III. Yeah, they had to do something. They put on a show. I saw Eric Erickson in the hall, and he said Iran is telling their people they killed 20 Americans. They had to put on a show for their people. And you have to understand, yes, he's a terrorist. We can say, you know, all the bad things about Soleimani, and they're true. But from the point of view of the Iranian government, they had to do something. That's just basic statecraft. They had to do something because we took out the second most powerful person in their government. They had to put on a show, and that's exactly what they did. What they did. The truth is that Iran called Iraq before they hit the launched the missiles, and there's some evidence that they back-channeled and let us know. The early warning sirens went off 2 hours before the missiles got there. This was Iran saying, let us put on this fireworks show for our people, and then we're going to pull back. Now, the other important thing to understand is the same threats that were around. This is more a condemnation of 24-hour news. There's really no difference between today at 11:41 and yesterday at 11:41 on Peachtree. The dangers are real. They are there. They are the same. Asymmetrical attacks through their militias, cyber warfare, terrorist one-offs, targeting Americans, asymmetrical. That we're still in that same situation with Iran right now as we were before. But it's really starting to get annoying that these people on the 24-hour news networks call themselves reporters and give zero context in these situations. I should not understand this immediately better than Anderson Cooper or Wolf Blitzer. People have been doing this for a very long time. Stop with the breathless end of the world. Every story is the end of the world. Because I have to believe they're smarter and they know better. It was obvious to me within 30 minutes of those missiles being launched. I would say 30. I thought. And then when I woke up this morning and saw where we are, I thought, okay, I got it right. And I'm supposed to believe that Wolf Blitzer actually thought we were at the edge of war, a wider war. Stop with the breathless end of the world if nothing is done about this. And start reporting the news. The news about what happened last night was news about statecraft. And it was obvious. Anybody who's taken one class on geopolitics, or me, who never took a class on geopolitics, just always was interested in the news and watched how these things happen. Idiotic to believe for a moment that Iran was going to go to war with the United, head-on-head war with the United States over this general's killing. We can hate them all they want. They're not that stupid. They have exactly zero chance up against the United States military. Now, what they'd rather do is maybe what happened in the early 2000s or in the mid-2000s or what's maybe still happening in Afghanistan. Get us in there, bang us, hit us, kill a few people. Never enough to turn into a huge conflict, but enough to always make American mothers and fathers begin to wonder why their kids are over there. That's their plan. And I don't know what I'm supposed to believe, that these people at MSNBC and Fox News and CNN are really the stupid. I don't. I think they're cynical. If I can get you to believe the world's coming to an end for just a few hours, you're not going to change the station, and I'm going to sell you some soap. That's what we used to say about commercials, selling soap.
And in case people didn't...
It was Fox News. They're going to sell you more catheters. What?
In case people didn't believe you, Eric, here's Trump himself saying exactly what you called this morning.
As we continue to evaluate options in response to Iranian aggression, the United States will immediately impose additional punishing economic sanctions on the Iranian regime. These powerful sanctions will remain until Iran changes its behavior.
Yeah, and he made a couple of interesting things that he said there. One is he blamed, you know, he made a direct allegation that the money that paid for the missiles that struck last night was from the money that came out of the nuclear deal when we had the billions of dollars on the pallets and all that. Yeah, I think it's kind of hard. Look, it's a general point that is true. The more cash they have, the more money they have, the more they can do.
We've seen the receipts.
Okay, we've seen the receipts. And also another part where he made news in there was like, I'm going to give you the real stuff. I'm not on CNN to talk about what this is going to do for the election. Another piece of real news is we are going to encourage NATO to take a greater role in, call it, Western affairs in the Middle East. And he mentioned, you know, with fracking and all of this, we don't need the Middle East for oil anymore. Very good point. Why have we always been bogged down there? Because oil is a commodity. And it's the reason we've been there since we started striking oil. So you're there, and then this happens, tit for tat. Next thing you know, you're in a war. And he made the point, well, we don't need that oil anymore. So NATO needs to step in and shoulder more of this responsibility. I'm sorry to bore you. Now you can go to your 24-hour, your favorite 24-hour news and figure out, what does this mean for the election?
Warning! Do not chug milk before listening, because you will laugh out loud.
Milk was a bad choice.
Eric and the Doctrinaires, mornings at 9. Mark Arum, evenings at 6 on 95.5 WSB.
Now, I never saw that show, Hamilton, because it seems kind of dumb to me. Founders rapping at each other. It seems silly to me. Not something I'd want to see. But it really is like it's the old thing about dueling. This is what happened, and I'm glad that the president realized it, and he was very smart about it. He said Iran has stood down. You know, you got to put the rhetoric. But in reality, what Iran did last night was, in a lot of these duels, they don't really shoot at each other, or they didn't. I don't know what went wrong for Alexander Hamilton. But most duels, anytime they go, well, it's saving face kind of thing. You go out there and you figure out a way to shoot. Each person shoots. Nobody gets hit. You walk away and no one can say you didn't stand up for yourself, right? That's what I would say, that Iran did throw away their shot. That's my little Hamilton.
You did it.
Thank you.
Did they work hard for their country?
You knew something.
And then we turned around and didn't, you know. We had an open micer who essentially said this earlier, but he was saying, I wonder if Trump will be smart enough.
I am reminded of the duel between Hamilton and Burr.
Or the play.
Hamilton fired first, but wasted his shot over Burr's head. But Burr heard a bullet go past him and, by all rights, was allowed to aim at, shoot, and kill Hamilton. Did Tehran waste their shot? All 10 missiles missed their mark. The question is, will Trump do the same, hold fire, or shoot to kill?
I don't know, but if there's any of those voiceovers that Orson Welles used to do, this guy needs to... What is that, a radio guy out of work? You know, this show is putting too many radio people out of work.
Bird's eye.
So, yeah, that's exactly what happened. They had to show their people, because normally Iran wouldn't even say it was them. The fact that they launched them from Iranian air, you know, and said it was theirs, this was a show they put on for their people, and I'm glad we didn't overreact. And it turns out here, you just sent this to me, I guess you follow porn star Jenna Jameson.
Mm-hmm.
I used to know somebody who dated her.
Oh, really?
I used to work with somebody, dated with her.
Well, now she's more of a political pundit, which is why I follow her.
She seems all right wing here. Yeah. She
well,
seems
laugh all you want.
She's all right. But she agreed, she agreed with me. Was this before it happened, or was this after Trump spoke?
The time
they said Trump's holds fire. Yeah. So, but she said, this is Jenna Jameson. She said, it's all a show. We're watching a scripted movie play out. Iran saving face, Trump holds fire. Hey, Jenna, you could have tuned in here 3 hours ago. I'm still beating Jenna Jameson to the news punch. Important. Bad actors in Iran got removed quietly now that Somalia's gone. Iranian people freed in time. Peace is the goal. And spoiler alert, says, I guess now former porn star Jenna Jameson, God wins.
Yep.
Ooh.
The problem is, if you're in Iran and you think God wins, well, look, let's not get messy.
Who's God?
Yeah, let's not get, hey, I'm not, this is a porn star. She's turning her life around. I'm not going to get too deep into it. So that's exactly what happened. And I'm glad for right now that now Trump has to not tweet, "I'll blow you off the planet." You know.
Any false moves and I'm sending more rockets.
After lunch. But again, really on a day like this, you really can't do this enough, which is just to give the middle finger to all the 24-hour news networks. What they were doing last night was cynical. There had to be 65 to 70% of people in those newsrooms who knew what this was. That there was almost no chance of escalating to all-out war. But boy, from 7 to midnight last night, that's what we got. Oh, and Erin Burnett, oh my goodness. Is that her name?
Yeah. Front.
Miss Grimm?
Miss Grimm.
Ms.
Just look at my face. Can you see how over this president I am? Can't believe I have to come in here and even talk about this stuff.
Well, she probably had a really good show planned.
Oh, yeah. God forbid news break out and ruin your planned news show.
How will this affect the impeachment?
Well, that's where we go now. Hey, call 15 people for a panel. I'd like to go back to, do we still have like that TV Eyes or whatever? You could go back and I would love to hear last night all the things that were going to happen and how this was going to be just the end of the end of the end. It's shameful. It's shameful. Wolf Blitzer and Anderson Cooper and Erin Burnett and, Brett Baer even, or anybody over, Sean Hannity, nobody knows. Nobody knows 10 minutes after an action like that takes place what all of the fallout is going to be. It's just irresponsible for one night on 24-hour news to try to convince the American people that we're in some sort of existential war situation when we never were. There are still threats and there are still dangers, but they're the same exact dangers as at 11:57 a.m. yesterday. Asymmetrical. This was a show put on for the Iranian people by the Iranian government. And anybody at CNN who pretends they didn't know that should be ashamed of themselves. That music tells me we're done on the radio side, but we're going to go over and do the podcast 30. If you'd like to join us over there, go to the Von Haessler Doctrine Facebook page or the WSB Radio Facebook page. Click on the red box and you can watch us do the podcast 30. Thanks for listening to the Von Haessler Doctrine Podcast. Remember, you can hear the show every weekday from 9 to noon right here on 95.5 WSB, Atlanta's news and talk. All right, the Podcast 30 begins right here and right now. As soon as we get those howling wolves, those barking dogs, those fighting washing machines to calm down. We got Tim Andrews is here. English Nick is here. J-Rad rocking the tunes. Autumn Fisher. Is Greg with us?
Yes.
Oh, from Studio B1. Greg Russ is here. Why do you have a dog on your hat?
Because I like these hats from Gorham Brothers.
Yeah, it's right. Got a dog on it. It says, good boy.
Yeah.
How do I know it's a boy?
I've also got a bird that says, hi. I've got a rooster that
What's
says
going
cock.
On? What's going on with you and hats?
My hair is not what it used to be. If I don't look, I'll show you what's going on.
Yeah, well, you know,
look at that mess,
don't
man.
You have some?
There you
all
go.
I gotta do
get
is
it,
date yourself a hairstylist for a week. You'll be fine.
Been there, done that.
So you can still cover up your baldness,
yeah.
Though.
You it's it's kind of like yours. It's behind there, right?
Yeah, mine's more.
But yeah, yeah, but you're older than more. Me.
Oh, by how much? Not so much. What, was I 5 when you were born?
22.
You're, how old are you, 52?
52.
All right, so I was 3 when you were born. I'm not exactly a senior.
You're so much older.
Yeah, wow. Wiser. Man, those 3 years? Are you kidding me? Between 64 and 67, a lot
a
of crap
generation.
Went down.
You were born the year my parents got married.
Wow.
Isn't that something?
Ivan and Caroline celebrated 50, what are you?
55.
They celebrated 55 last year.
Congratulations to them. Do you want to know this?
What's that?
It was the fact that they found out that I was born that made them decide to get married. They said, you
We've
know what?
Got to have a Nick.
You know, no, they said, we got to get a friend. We got to create a friend for this guy. And obviously, it's okay to have kids. This Eric von Haessler is going to be in the world for a few years. Mm-hmm. That's going to make things
there's
better.
There's a poor kid born in the United States that my British poor, child is going to be friends with.
A poor, tall kid.
Yeah. What are the odds that we would meet each other? You think about where we started from.
I know.
You all rich over there living in a mansion?
Oh, sure.
Yeah, I wish. Castle. Castle. They call them castles.
That's right. They're castles over there.
Farm animals.
Yes.
Speaking of birthdays, thanks to Nick, I know that the Starman would have been 73 today.
Yeah, is
that
David Bowie?
David Bowie. Yeah. Is he has the same birthday as Elvis?
Yeah, Elvis Presley Elvis's would have been 80 something today.
And Kim Jong-un.
85. 85.
We have Elvis Presley. We have 80-year-old Elvis Presley.
I'm an old man. I'm 80.
You'll sound 80.
Well, I feel really good.
Sound like you're there, you
it's
die.
The prime.
Sound 42.
Hey, a side note on the Elvis thing. My friends over at the Corner Tavern in Little Five Points,
yeah,
they're serving the peanut butter, banana, and bacon sandwiches today.
Oh, there you go.
And they're doing Elvis karaoke tonight at 9 o'clock.
And, oh.
Jared,
there
you go.
I was going to tell you what they're going to do at the Star Bar, but that was canceled.
That's not at Star Bar. Nope. Not
we
for
had some
a minute.
People yelling at us on our Facebook page.
Wait. It's Kim Jong-un's birthday, too.
Oh, yes. Excuse me, please. That's the real king.
Yep.
안녕하세요.
Huh? Right. Exactly. Uh-huh. You and me.
Yep.
Or you and I. What happened there? Are you still playing drums over there?
No.
I heard music.
No,
heard
somebody dropped something.
That was me. I dropped. You're talking about old baby Kim Jong.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized that my mouse pad since January 18, 2016 has been a copy of The New Yorker. Am I on video screen there? But it's got
no, we can't see you.
It's got Kim on the cover.
Oh yeah.
Instead of getting a real mouse pad, it's a magazine.
I somehow during the taping of the shows and the whole Christmas thing, I lost my mouse pad, and I've been using just loose paper.
Is your cat got it?
No.
Oh. Mm. He took his computer into the station.
Yeah, so probably
that's right. You did, didn't you?
I lost a couple of things. That
probably
were
with that hard drive.
I hate to say this.
And those SD cards.
No, and that's I can't.
It's all wrapped up somewhere.
I don't know. I haven't seen my gift from Autumn. I don't know.
What was the gift?
It could be my
scarf.
My scarf, yeah.
He's great.
No, I'm not. What are you saying? That I don't think it's
no,
great?
No, I'm complimenting Autumn. I used it over the break.
Thank you.
What'd you
I'm
use it
you
for?
Like it.
You know, it's supposed to go around your neck.
Oh, I just cleaned
it. Yeah, it went around somebody else's neck.
I used mine, too.
You're not supposed to kill people with it.
I still just use socks.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Do you wipe,
to stay warm.
As a scarf. Cold.
Did you wipe yourself? Did you wipe yourself? You didn't wipe yourself, I hope.
Hey, Autumn, I rolled a joint with that president plate you got.
Oh, well, there you go.
Yay!
By the way, that's exactly what that plate should be for.
I know.
Absolutely.
He texted that to me. He's like, I'm going to break things up on this plate.
Rolling the joint and chopping lines. That's what
there's not.
For.
There's not a
chopping lines would ruin it. I don't.
But you don't. There's no real stems and seeds anymore. You don't really need
speak
it
for yourself.
I've used the scarf for some bondage situations in the last couple weeks.
Hold on. I'm not talking about derogatory terms for your junk.
No. I'm saying that you could still accidentally get that if you're not careful.
Oh, really?
The stems and the things.
Yes. I've been told by my friends.
You just grind it, man. It all comes out as one.
It all tastes terrible.
What?
Well, if you grind the wheat?
No, if you grind up the seeds and the stems. Isn't that a shame? I went to Denver for a day.
No, I don't put I wouldn't put a bunch of seeds in there and grind
it.
I'm saying
if
there's anything if there's anything in there,
it grinds it into one.
There's no need. Yeah. It's just one thing. You know,
I'm going to say it's a shame that these days that kids aren't going to know the sound of popping pot seeds.
Right.
Yeah. Oh,
and then
hitting
you in the face.
Yeah.
Then ruining your favorite new shirt. Oh, got that hole in there now.
My Led Zeppelin shirt.
Oh, man.
Somehow it always ends up right next to the buttonhole. I don't know how that always.
The inevitable pinhole burn.
All down my favorite.
Satin
shirt. Autumn would have to knit a lot more clothing articles if that was the case. Like if there was popping seeds everywhere.
I am. Can I apologize for something?
Yes.
I had the hiccups.
Oh, losing her.
You always get the hiccups.
No,
the
I got the hiccups about 3 months ago. That's not always getting the hiccups.
Every time you hear me slur, you get the hiccups.
Oh, that's the...
Let's turn them upside down, Tim.
Three months ago, I think it was much sooner or much more recent than
It could have been more recent than 3 weeks ago.
Every time I get the hiccups, I assume I'm going to be the man where they never go away.
Yeah,
I
read, me too.
It was in the 90s at some point. I saw a story on this guy. The hiccups came. They never left.
Yeah.
What a
Which
curse.
Which I don't believe. I feel like that's kind of a lie. Because you know, like people who say, I didn't sleep a wink last night.
Yeah, they slept.
I'm sure you did.
They slept.
It's the same thing.
Wink.
Like, I've had the hiccups for 6 months. Like, yeah, I bet you didn't.
Yeah, but you know what? You wouldn't want their life. If you're saying, I've had the hiccups for 6 months, you've had...
Remember that guy who couldn't stop burping? Do you remember that guy that couldn't stop burping? Every few minutes.
Yeah, but his wife loves
it. It's the same people. It's like the people who orgasm constantly. They have hyper arousal something.
Yeah. Is that women or men?
Mainly women.
Well, I think it's not me. I think it's women.
Yeah, mainly women.
Hyper arousal.
Yeah.
I'm the opposite.
They can't stop orgasming.
That doesn't sound good to me.
Now, no, it's a curse.
Actually, if you could have an orgasm every time you hiccup, that'd be something.
It would be.
Yeah, it'd still be too much.
You'd have messy pants.
Well, as a guy, you'd be in a bit of a mess.
Well, it depends. If you're wearing the compression pants, at least it's contained.
I got it, but there's no more. I only have the one pair of compression underwear.
Wait, okay. I have two things to say. One, if you were a man and having constant orgasms, eventually it would just dust.
Yeah.
Would come out, and then a flag.
Well, then nothing.
Like
nothing
in the gun,
out.
Those guns.
I that makes me want to tell you something, but I can't.
If dust comes out, you got more problems then.
Yeah. Well, eventually you're going to run out.
I think it's because of age. I don't know. Sometimes you think that there's going to. I can't say it.
I know exactly. I know exactly.
You go,
what
wow, that's
say.
Less than I imagined.
Of course,
is that because we're getting older?
It does, I think you do
you
have
don't
less
make
there.
It. You know, there's no reason to make it anymore.
Plenty of reasons. I'm trying to trick evolution.
Well,
into
evolution
thinking
can't
that
be
I
tricked.
Might still give birth.
Okay.
Wow, this guy's really active.
Hey, let me tell you. Look, you cannot fool Mother Nature.
Okay.
The what? Second thing I wanted to ask you was about your compression pants. Why are you wearing underwear?
Dr. Joe,
compression?
As a joke, I said, hold on.
Oh, he got you Spanx.
Wow.
These are helping his sack.
Wow.
She's writing that off before he even told the story.
No, she was writing him off. Did you see what happened there? Oh, okay.
Greg had a little groan in there, too.
Wow. Yeah.
That's the reaction that it stirs.
GLG, Greg's little groan. That's a podcast in itself right there. 5 minutes, Greg's little groan.
Beware.
Talk about cynical,
beware,
not me. You're
beware,
talking about cynicism on your show
beware,
all morning.
Beware,
buy my book!
Beware of cast members who go back and forth in the comments section with listeners. Beware.
Oh.
Because they can sometimes believe that what they're seeing there is the actual feeling on the street. So you got to be careful
on the screen.
With that one. Now, so Dr. Joe, love him or hate him, he, as a joke... They sewed some, what did they sew into these?
Oh, the butt pads.
Yeah, because I was saying I don't have much of a butt anymore.
No behind.
Yes, you need
Spanx
the cushion.
Getting their,
so
after menswear.
I got home, and it turned out they were just joking around. They just very lightly put those in there. They're like shoulder pad things in women's. Mm. I pulled them out.
How do you know that?
How do I know that? Because I'm an adult. What do I have to? What are you insinuating?
Oh, hey,
that I'm a
hey,
homosexual because I know what women shoulder pads are?
Well, I mean, you seem very knowledgeable about it.
Oh, being come on.
How is that a thing? I'm gay now because I know about women's shoulder pads?
Actually,
yeah,
I mean, you
gay.
Said that. I didn't say that.
Actually, it means you're very straight because you've been in the room where a woman has gotten naked with you and taken off the shoulder pad item.
Well, the truth is I've decided that I'm asexual.
Oh, right.
Nah, I don't know. No one's
there's zero humility.
You believe that from anybody? Oh, I'm asexual. Oh, really? You get no. That doesn't.
Morrissey.
That's real. That's
too.
Real.
It's no. It may be real that you don't act on it, but it's not real that anybody is alive and never thinks about having sex.
Oh, well.
That's priests? Not real.
I think it's real. I know priest. Someone, but I don't want to talk about their business.
Who said priest?
Me.
No, priests.
Yeah, even if somebody might be still a virgin at an older priests age, they still think about
priests
sex.
Are not pretending to say they're asexual. They say that they fight against that part of themselves. And as we can see through the lawsuits, sometimes lose. So that's not...
Autumn wants to challenge
so,
you on that
so, one. So my thing is, I easily pulled those things out, and I was like, so I said, oh, I'm going to wear these, and I loved them.
Why
I
do you like them so much? Everything's
because,
compressed?
Because
like a diaper.
What I don't like... What I don't like is I don't like things fall out and
hang.
Yeah, I just like
and slippage.
I don't mind that slippage around.
I don't like
gossip.
It. You know, as you get older,
even in the summer, Nick, you don't mind
oh,
the slippage.
Just make
it sticks.
You know what? It makes me feel like I'm alive. Like
you know,
it's still something
use,
going on
I,
down there.
I could use those. I could. That could be
parts
like
parts of my body still stick to other
still
parts
works.
Of my body. I'm so alive.
If I relaxed enough at this age, it would like be like dropping the landing gear on the airplane before you actually. And I could probably use them as training wheels if I. So I like
your landing gear stuck.
So, but you wear either normally you wear like tidy whiteies, right?
Well, they're not always white, but yeah, the tidy.
You mean
yeah.
like Speedos so or shorts?
Not Speedos. Oh. I'm not Italian.
No, no. Why don't you wear instead of the compression panties? Why don't you wear some like
excuse me.
Boxer briefs, boxer because briefs that's like best. A good
boxer
marriage.
No, I tried the boxer briefs, and the problem for me with the boxer briefs is when I pull up my jeans, then I got to put my hands back down there and push
the leg down.
That means that they're too big. Down.
Yeah, you got
that
buy
means
them
that they're too big. You
I
need to buy
fronts.
A smaller size.
I'm a wide fronts man.
A what?
And you're small and you're skinnier now, so you can get.
Well, that's
a smaller
some
size
of the problem is like, the skinniness is becoming a problem.
You know what, wide
first of all, there's the hiccups.
The skinniness is a problem.
Well, I don't know. I do like it. It feels better.
You need
I
to
like
go shopping
it.
Is what you need
I think to
do.
Myself as I'm walking around now. I think to myself, "Wow, you're aerodynamically cutting through the air so much better and crisper than you used
eventually
to.
I'll be 2D."
All the way.
It's almost like those scenes in superhero movies where the superhero comes by like a flash.
Yeah.
That's how it is now. Was that Von Haessler? I think
I kind of amaze myself. Like I used to I'm so used to not looking at myself in the mirror when I get out of the shower. And then I have to remind myself, no, you can look now.
Ooh, now you touch yourself. Ooh,
oh, now I'm like,
yeah. Get that Divinyl song on.
Yeah.
I touch myself. I want you to tell me.
A string of hits from that band.
Oh, huge.
I got to lose another 15. What do you think?
What? No, you'd be too skinny.
Divinyl's donated $50 to the
start
wildfire.
Start putting on some for them.
Yeah.
Put on some muscle mass.
I do need to do that, too. I weighed 186 pounds when I met my wife.
How much
I
do you weigh
skin
now?
And bones. I'd probably be down about 2. I was up to like 2:30.
Maybe you start with one of those easy gyms, you know, like one of the ones where they don't make.
What the hell are you? What's an easy gym?
An easy gym, like one of the ones where they.
Easy gym.
They don't shame on. They
you
don't shame you
up.
While you're in there.
You just show up.
You just show up yeah. and you get you pay.
Don't go to
25.
A gym. Do push-ups at home.
Oh, you said gym. I thought you said gem.
No, a gym.
Oh, like easy gyms.
No, you said if you want to get a little.
You're going to do one of those reverse auctions I see on TV on the.
Yeah.
Just get one of those what you
I
call
don't
it.
Need an easy gym. It's the one thing you've learned from me. I don't need how people are told.
No, someone will get murdered at the gym and they'll think of me.
I think I'll do a gym.
Don't be a child there.
I don't need to try to.
Oh, we know you so well by now.
I don't need. I'm not going to be trying to look like Schwarzenegger, right? If I just, I would just want just a little bit of
no, but you
definition.
Need toning.
But sometimes it's nice to have all that equipment there. So when you walk in,
yeah,
that's what she said.
You can
you go to Target. Listen,
you have lots of choices.
Yeah.
When you're in
listen,
there,
you go to you go to Target. You go to the rarely visited aisle with all of the workout equipment past mm-hmm. the toys before yeah. the seasonal stuff.
Yeah.
And you get like a 10-pound like little dumbbell. Girly weight. And you just walk around your pool you
with
know,
that weight
every day.
In your hand.
Yeah. And you go up and down. You do like a couple yeah. of these.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You get your shoulders strong.
Yeah. I'm going to start walking backward like my Chinese neighbor's parents do in my neighborhood.
When you go to Target, though, don't cut through the women's underwear aisle. Because I do that sometimes. I feel like a creep.
I linger.
It's... I'm sure you linger for different reasons. I'm trying to, the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. Mm-hmm. And sometimes a straight line is through the, I'll go the long way.
Sometimes, you know, what I've found is with you, the straight line seems to go through the women's underwear area all the time. Your straight line.
Especially a way to get to a part of the different aisle faster is to ask a lady in that department, like, would these fit my girlfriend? Mm. You will look about her size. Will you try on this bra?
I like walking through the Walmart one and you go, is this a bra or a parachute? Oh, Autumn rolled her eyes.
No, it's a reusable.
No, Walmart has the big.
Oh, of course they have. You see their clientele?
Yeah, the giant ones.
They're reusable shopping bags, is what they are.
What are you haying? As if there aren't a lot of fat people at Walmart.
Yeah. Everybody people needs. Got the, you know,
yeah, they
got
to be comfortable in their size.
They got the bazoom bods.
The bazooms.
Then go to Dress
Barn. Got them mashed potato things.
Just because they have H cups doesn't mean
go
that's
to
a
Dress
bad
Barn.
Thing.
That's what that's for.
You know what Greg is? He's angry. This is off the subject, but I know that Greg is angry. I want to give him a moment to
express
vent,
himself.
Express himself. Because,
I got bumped for bra talk.
He got bumped. His cat's review was bumped today.
For Eric's desk and sawhorse talk.
Well, listen.
Desk and sawhorse.
Wait, this is a current event show.
People needed an update on the death.
It just it was the most current event in my life, except for the thing that happened in Iran.
Can't get...
In that defense, Katz is not current. It was released 4 weeks ago. So
no, yeah, I didn't even know it was released until I saw all the bad reviews.
Well, it's on video now, so it's sort of breaking.
Downloadable.
How hard is it to make a
Buy
great
the
movie
Joker, get
about
for free.
A musical that's been around forever?
We're not getting into it now. We're saving this discussion.
Greg, okay, but
me,
I will say this.
Me.
I will
You're
say
dying
this.
To tell me.
I will say this. They used to some of the most famous musicals on movie musicals started out as Broadway shows. Obviously, South Pacific, Guys and Dolls,
Chicago.
Chicago was made relatively well relatively recently.
Moulin Rouge was made really well a few years back too.
Yeah, but I'm talking about the shows that are big. Like Guys and Dolls was a huge show. South Pacific was a huge
Phantom
show.
Phantom of the Opera.
West Side Story. No, Phantom of the Opera is what I'm talking about. Oklahoma. These shows that have been big in our time. Phantom of the Opera,
Cats.
They don't. They try to make. There was a Phantom of the Opera thing. It was terrible.
Horrible.
For some reason,
Les Mis was good.
Like West Side Story, they took it out to the streets of New York City and they made a movie out of it. And it just seems like. Did you see that thing that they put on TV for Rent?
The live performance.
Oh my God. It's like, you know, look, maybe this works if you're in the room.
Yeah.
But it doesn't work sitting in my living room watching it on television. If you're going to make a movie, you have to make a movie. I guess in this situation, with all the CGI and everything, they tried to. But my guess is, and we'll get to the review tomorrow, but my guess is that overall, there's flashiness, but it's empty at the core. There's something just not there. Synthetic.
Yeah.
Unreal. And you can't say that about West Side Story or The Sound of Music or these other things that were stage plays, but they made them genuine movies when they turned them into movies rather than this weird... Although I do want to take shrooms and go see it.
Yes.
I don't want to take shrooms. Mm. I'm not a tripping...
I would advise against that.
Of course not.
You would?
Why?
I want to save it all.
Okay, he's got a review, and he doesn't want to. All right.
Yeah, let's get off this topic.
Yeah, okay.
Move
pal.
On. Let's go. Is there more sawhorse talk?
Yes.
Yeah, Eric, send me for real. Send me the information. I want to look into it.
All right, I will, because I don't want to deal with it.
Yeah, I want to
Can
know.
Can you call my wife?
Are you talking about this table?
Ah, yeah, blah, blah, blah.
Are you talking about the table?
I can't do your wife. It sounds like Roseanne.
They don't know.
Nick, the outrage.
Hold on. They don't know who
I've
my wife is.
The glass top didn't come.
They're not aware. Yeah. It's
Which
okay.
is. Screwed
Hello,
up.
I'm Eric's wife. Yeah.
Hang on, question. You
and
sure
demand a glass top.
You sure it's not coming in a second package?
Well, that's right.
It's been a week. I've had it since last Saturday. What I have.
The best part was you trying to convince yourself that the rectangle top was a square yesterday. I'm like, Eric, there's no way that this rectangle
hey, I don't
glass
know.
This is a big point
hey,
for Jared. Jared
well,
really feels strong in
well,
this conviction.
Well, what he doesn't understand.
I do. I feel very strong
about it.
What
he does not understand is that packaging is deceptive at times. So there could
that's
have been.
That's what she said.
Maybe it was some of that foldable glass.
Yeah, maybe. New technology.
That's what she said. The package is foldable sometimes.
Two uses
Get it?
In you one show for that hack
Stop joke. Trying to be such a broad.
Woo!
You guys, She's a guy gal.
You Talking guys, about people's packages. You know what I mean?
You guys and girls say rectangle and not oblong?
I don't say oblong.
I say oblong.
Oblong makes me, it's disconcerting.
Oblong.
Oblong sounds like you. I want to repeat it. Go like oblong, blong, blong, blong.
It's obviously long. Is that the point? Oblong?
I guess so.
Oblong.
It's also a new character in the third Star Wars TV show that's going to come out on Disney.
Oblong.
Oblong.
Is that the new Skywalker?
here's
a woman who's even more perfect than the other women that we told you about. She doesn't poo.
Have you guys all seen
That's how great she is.
Have you guys all seen the terrible new Star Wars movie?
No,
yeah. I have.
Oh, it's dire. It's absolutely dire.
I know, it's awful.
Ugh.
Mandalorian's better than all those.
That's what everybody says.
God, yes it is.
I got to go back and I have to watch the second part of the Doctor Who thing because I watched the first part.
Oh, then
any good?
The New Year's
No, it's not any good. They've worked themselves into such a corner. There's no way to get out of it. It's just terrible.
Aren't the regenerations over anyway? Didn't those end 2 doctors ago?
No, they were supposed to, but they came with some sort of Gallifreyan loophole.
You mean as in regenerating the Doctor?
Yeah, why did they
there were like there were 12. There were 12.
There was supposed to be the 11th or the 12th was supposed to be the limit.
Right.
And that was something they came up with, I think, in the 60s. They didn't realize. But I don't know what they did. I can't remember what they did, but they worked their way around it. But it's just so bad. It's so bad. It's beyond bad. You know,
I know there's a lot of younger people
who
still love
just,
it.
You just can't. Maybe if I was a 13-year-old girl, I might like it, but I'm not
the
audience.
People in their 20s seem to be raving about it still.
Who? Who?
Just some people I've
can
met.
I ask you something? Can I tell you? That's a lie.
No,
that's
it's a lie.
You want to know why?
That's
a lie.
No,
it's a lie.
Why
because
is it a lie?
They sell nothing. Doctor Who, like figurines and stuff, those things for every doctor were very popular. Nobody buys the stuff from this. That's one. Mm. That's one way you can tell that is. Same thing's true with the new Star Wars merchandise. I mean, it sells. It's
Tim
like Star
got
Wars.
A new Rey figure.
It's, yeah, it's like Star Wars is going to be the number one movie in the world, no matter what,
course,
right?
Of course.
But nobody likes it. And if you really want to know if people like it, it's are they going out and buying all the toys? They're buying some toys, but they're not breaking records with the toys because who the hell? I'm sorry, Rey does not turn on 10-year-old kids the way Luke Skywalker did because Luke Skywalker was an adventurous hero. Mm. And I don't know what Rey is. I like the actress.
I think she's awesome.
Character.
She's the best thing about the movie as far
the
as I'm
actress,
concerned.
She's fine. Yeah. But the character is perfect, which makes her boring. She's the greatest. We have no reason to understand why she's the greatest of
people
all
love
of these.
To remove stakes from movies.
Yeah, well, because, yeah. Well, you do that whenever you elevate perfect people.
Hey,
you know, yeah. if she's perfect, then I don't have to worry about her being killed or doing anything
test
wrong.
Well,
or
she wasn't. You
know. No, it's because they want to prove it's like your male white characters are obsolete. They're oblong. They're obsolete.
Oh, see, now I thought it would be because they want the like Rey character to appeal to little girls, and they don't want a character that has flaws to appeal to little girls.
No, they want, right. But the point is, first they have to tell the 55-year-old who was sitting in 1977 at the first Star Wars that you've always been wrong about what your heroes should look like. That's the first thing. I mean, did you see the one, The Last Jedi?
Yeah.
I mean, most of all that Laura Dern stuff, you know, with the guy.
Oh, that was ridiculous.
She might as well just go, oh, men always want to break things.
Abrams
got
rid of
that. It didn't make any sense. It didn't
yeah,
make any
he totally
sense for
did.
Her not to communicate things with the people that need to know things.
Yeah, it was perfectly okay for people to think that she was taking them into nothingness.
I'm just glad that Carrie Russell showed up in that cat suit with that gold helmet on.
Yeah,
was she that even
seconds.
Really her?
That was,
did
was
you get
that,
to see her face?
Yeah, you did see her face. I couldn't believe
I heard
it was her.
Awful.
I
heard it was awful.
Look,
you don't know who she is, why she's there. There's a backstory,
all,
but you're not even told.
When did she become a Jedi?
She's not a
she's
Jedi.
She's not a Jedi. She's kind of
oh,
like
you're
her.
Talking about Rey?
No, I mean, no. I thought, isn't she trained by Carrie Fisher?
No, she's
Rey
trained
is,
by...
Yes.
Yeah, well, when was Princess
Luke
Leia?
Trained Rey, and they showed you a flashback
but Princess
of that.
It's in her
is...
blood. It's in her blood, because
yeah,
she's Anakin's...
Yeah, but you had
the
to be trained
chose
according
her.
To the original.
She was never
she's
trained.
She's the chosen one. She's perfect.
Hey, you know what? You're trying to throw too much into this Star Wars conversation.
No!
Just in the way they threw too much into that movie!
No, why am I in this
send
movie?
The Dementors in.
Why am I in this
you can think that I'm full of it.
No,
and,
I don't.
But I will tell you that if you look at Terminator, what happened? Ruined. Spoiler alert. They walk in, they kill the kid that you think was the hero. Why? To replace with women. Doctor Who. You could have made a badass female doctor. You know what a badass doctor of any kind wouldn't talk about their gender all the time? I don't remember the male doctors repeating the fact that they were men. Constantly.
Well, thank God I'm a man. I can get something done.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you're right, though.
And then, Star Trek has been ruined. All this stuff has been ruined. And all you have to do, none of it's necessary. All you have to do is tell new stories, really cool stories, and feature women in those stories, and that's fine. You don't have to destroy what happened beforehand in this thing in order to make some sort of sociological point.
I saw an interview with Daniel Craig before Christmas, or around Christmas, in England.
And he said, I think a female Bond will be better.
No, he said, yeah, you know, there should be great stories. All the stories. It should be great stories everywhere for women and people of color and stuff. Just write those stories.
Thank you. That's what I've been saying.
He's on that train.
Well, I mean, it's like there's no reason why you can't have a female...
No.
00 whatever,
nope.
And just start making a series of movies and make them more bad, make them great. Who cares?
Just call her
Double
D7.
Those movies.
Yes.
Actually, you
just
should
stop making them.
You should stop making Bond movies.
No.
I believe they're Bourne movies now. I think that they changed when the Bourne movies started.
Maybe.
And they're like that. They're not tongue in cheek anymore. You can't have fun.
It's a lot to do with
Bond's asexual now. I don't know if you know that.
Oh, good.
No, it's a lot to do with how Daniel Craig is as an actor. He plays that darker Bond anyway.
He's got to deal with the script.
It's boring.
Yeah. Right.
Hey, what about that scene where I don't remember which one it was, he was in that chair and the bottom
getting
was cut out.
Nuts.
Yeah.
Now that one, I tell you, I did not find that to be believable because you would have pooped, you know, within
a
minute.
No, but he's boned.
Right?
He's boned.
No, no,
I would have given up whatever they want.
Here you go. He's sitting in that seat, right? You would let everything go.
You would. Totally.
I mean, almost immediately.
Yeah, you're not
there's so many. No.
And
I
also,
don't know,
but, oh, I'm sorry, but there's nobody who has the ability to put up with repeated blows to the nads. No one.
Johnny Steelsack does.
There's no toughness in the world
one time I'd be done.
First of all, he wouldn't have been able to walk. He wouldn't have been able to walk for a year.
He's Bond. Come on.
No. He's a superhero now?
Do you know it was always fantastical.
I know, but here's the point with Bond. When we were growing up, our number one enemy in this country was the Soviet Union. And when you watched Bond movies, they just named who the enemy was and quite often dealt with the enemy. How many Bond movies since 9/11? How many?
Four, maybe.
Five.
Have we addressed the real threat to the West at all?
That's offensive.
They're just these random dudes, then.
No, they switched to the Serbs.
When was the Pierce Brosnan one where he surfed the tidal wave on a car door? What year was that?
I can't.
Was that post 9/11? I think that was.
Yeah. I only saw one. I only saw the first Pierce Brosnan. He seemed like he was.
Yeah, and he made one or two,
Bond.
Didn't he?
Yeah. Better
he
than Daniel.
GoldenEye was great.
You like him better than Daniel Craig?
Yes.
My wife does not like Daniel Craig as Bond.
Me
she
either.
She thinks he looks like a boxer. She doesn't like his face.
I'm a fan.
He looks like a raisin.
Yeah, if my wife doesn't like your face,
like
as
a
an
golden
actor,
raisin.
You're just out. That's the weird thing about my wife. She can't watch Sylvester Stallone movies. She hates his face.
His face has gotten whacked, hasn't it? It's crazy.
I can't look at his face.
What do you mean, like the original Rockies and stuff?
Yeah,
Well, his face is all right back then.
She hates his face then.
Now he's been punched by Jason Statham so many times.
I'm that way, though.
Movies.
I can't watch, what's his name, Mickey Rourke?
Oh.
Now?
Oh.
I can't watch.
Is he in anything?
It's distracting.
Wrestler.
Yes, he's been in a bunch
movie.
Of movies, but he's got
that
awful face.
That was 20 years ago, wasn't it?
Not 20, but
15,
not far
maybe.
Away.
How did he
for,
not do
for
anything
the record,
like
Iron Man 2.
Oh, he's terrible in that.
Yes. Yes, for the record, Mr. For the Record.
Which record?
Die Another Day with the surfing the tidal wave scene. First Bond film post 9/11.
All right, and then who's the enemy?
It was probably shot and written before 9/11.
But how many movies did Brosnan make? Only one,
right?
Three.
He was captured by North Korean agents and must serve a grueling prison sentence. He's finally released and convinced that someone in his own agency betrayed him. He escapes from custody, goes to Cuba, hot on the heels of an agent who put Behan.
That's all with Halle Berry, right?
There's three
and then repeatedly gets his nuts electric.
Yeah.
That's how he charges himself.
This is what I was going to say, is that there's so many movies that come out where we have to explore the dark, gritty past.
Yeah.
This once kind of fun, entertaining movie. If they started remaking the Indiana Jones or something, and we really got
haunted.
To see the abuse between his dad.
Take your pants off.
Well, here's what I would like. A character, a character who's dark. I want a character who's dark and they explore his past or her past, and the parents are loving, giving the child cake, coddling, kissing, tucking in at night, and then just, why are you doing this? Because I want to.
It's because it's the Greg Greg Russ story.
It's like the Christmas.
Yeah. Greg,
perfectly fine parents.
Greg can relate to that one.
I like to kill.
It's the Christopher Nolan Batman with Joker.
He's got a new but that's great.
Except we don't know the backstory, but he is someone who's truly an anarchist, and it's fun to see that. And I know you talked about Joker, but that is a dark character that I want to see some of the origins of, and that's cool. So
that's fine.
But
I mean, that wasn't even the real
when you're
Joker.
Talking about a movie,
it wasn't
that
an origin story though.
It was
well, the cool thing in that
was.
Film was he kept telling different stories about his past. I mean, it was
what I'm saying is that that's not the Joker. That's why the word "the" is not in the title. It's just Joker.
I know.
It's a Joker.
For me, I'm not paying attention to whatever everyone's saying.
The only origin part of that is that somebody in a clown mask killed Thomas Wayne.
I understand officially on the record. I understand on the record it's not supposed to be the Batman Joker, but I don't care. I wanted to watch that movie, and then I wanted to watch the Christopher Nolan.
And I got to the end. Well, Christopher Nolan apparently has a new movie out. It's supposed to be great.
What's
coming
that?
Out? I can't remember what it was, but it sounds great. All of his stuff just
I'm ready
sounds
for the
great
new,
to me.
What's his name's got a new movie. Guy Ritchie's got one coming out end of the month.
I wasn't a big
Go Fast or Die.
No. Snatch and all that. Stop the Two Smoking Barrels.
Too fast for me.
Great movies.
Having sex with a Madonna and all that.
We sell copious amounts of ganja.
Didn't he do a couple Bond movies?
No.
He did one called He did a movie called Layer Cake that was kind of.
After he married Madonna, his movies bombed.
Oh yeah, because they made that Swept Away, which was the apparently at the time it made less money than any other movie in history. It was a remake, so it had to make less than the one before it. All right, that music says to me
it's time to go.
Yeah, Autumn's texting people, and she's not into it anymore. So I'm gonna.
I got things to do.
I'm gonna pull the plug here.
She's got things to do. Uh-huh.
All right, guys, I've enjoyed the day. I'm glad that my prediction at the beginning of the day that we were not on the edge of a wider war turns out to be true.
Is that true?
Good job.
Thank you. Uh-huh. Yeah, you know.
That was impressive. You knew exactly what was going
to
happen.
You have to be calm in situations. And you know, the real reason we can do that is because we have a great show. We don't have to scare the hell out of people to keep them tuned in.
And so an amazing president.
And thank you, sir.
Yes. Wow.
Eric, sensationalize it. Sensationalize.
The
go.
The way he delivered that was so...
But hey, let me just say
breathing this. Breathing in his nose.
You never know. Tomorrow could be the last day of all time, so don't miss our show. Bye-bye.
Yeah. Maybe forever.
Uh-huh. It's the living daylights, I tell you.
That's the theme for the new Bond movie.